Okay, so we will call this meeting to order. This is the July 6th meeting of Yellow Springs Village Council. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes, Wintrow.
I'm here.
Asklin.
Yes.
Sims.
Here.
Pausch.
Here.
McQueen.
Here.
Also present are Chief of Police Hale, Assistant Village Manager John Young, Village Manager Patty Bates, and Finance Director Melissa Van Zandt. Oh, and Chief of Electric and Water back there.
Chief. Wow, he has a new title.
Wow.
Congratulations.
Chief Johnny.
Thank you. Announcements.
Yeah, I have two. First of all, I just wanted to emphasize, I guess, that the first Vita Award, Village Inspiration and Design Award, was given, presented on Art Stroll at the Arts Council. And the Callahans were really excited. And if you want to see the work that John Hudson did, it's at 1580 Quarry Street, along with the Sculpture Garden that was our first award winner. And we're already getting some nominations for the fall. The other thing is I wanted to give a big shout out to the Odd Fellows, as well as the village team, the fire department, and
the Lions
County.
Club.
Yeah, the Lions Club. Everybody that helped out with a really amazing 4th of July weekend. Super weather, super fun. I heard lots of great feedback, and can't wait for next year.
Thank you. Any other announcements? Excuse me. So we have a consent agenda that includes the minutes of the June 1st regular council meeting, the June 15th work session, and the financials for May of 2015. Can I get a motion to approve, or is everyone satisfied with that as the consent agenda? Motion for approval?
I move that we approve.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
In an abstain.
Oh,
you oh right. I'm sorry. I have also to abstain.
Oh.
I did read them, but obviously I wasn't there.
Yeah, I did have an
Oh, that's true. So it's three to three, yes. I guess.
For the June 15th,
right.
You have to abstain.
Well, do we need to pull that out, Chris?
What's well.
Okay. June 15th, two council members were missing. So we should probably pull that out and have a separate vote, because we don't want it to look like a 3-0 vote for the financials. Okay. Mm-hmm. Let's rescind. We'll pretend we didn't even have that vote. So so the consent agenda, let's pull out June 15th, because we do have a couple of council members missing. So the consent agenda will be the minutes of June 1st and the financials for May. Can I have a motion to
approve? Yes, I move the revised consent agenda.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Sorry,
Lori, do you need some help?
You.
I think I got
you
it.
You have to go under there and
yeah.
Push
uh-oh.
It
up.
I
yeah.
fixed it one
time. Did you get it?
Not sure.
All right.
So while this
okay.
is going on, so we will now consider approval of the minutes of the June 15th work session. Can I get a motion for approval?
Sure. So moved.
Second.
You're the only two that can do that. That's good. all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 No, I can't.
Well,
sorry.
All those who abstain.
Lori. I abstain.
Abstain.
Sorry. I abstain.
Jerry.
Abstain.
Okay. Now we're on to a review of the agenda for tonight's meeting. Anything that anybody sees that they would like to remove, any additions or any relocations?
Yeah, I'd like to remove under old business the first line item, information on ICLEI. Duart Headley is doing that, and he's out of town.
Okay, mm-hmm. Sounds good. I never object to shortening the agenda.
Mary Ann, do we need to move
so
that to the
that
next?
At the next meeting?
Well, should it be, let's, since we are kind of the next couple of meetings are a little bit up in the air
okay.
as to whether they're official or not, we'll discuss that in the August.
Okay.
Yeah, I just wrote
right.
the agenda.
Right.
Planning.
And we also, I'd like to add there are three commission nominations.
Okay, we'll put that under new business for all the same commission.
One is community access panel, and two for the public art commission.
Okay, so we'll add commission nominations to new business. Okay, and anything else? Okay, Lori, would you review the few communications we received?
Okay, yeah, I'm just going to talk about the two letters. Possibly Mary Ann would want to talk about the flyer that Duard put in about the Resilience Network. But the two letters were both thanking the village for the work that was done. I believe they were both about the same.
They were.
Work.
Yes.
Done on Phillips Street and, I'm sorry, I don't have my email.
Davis.
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 Yes. From Phillips on down.
Yes, Phillips and West Davis, both of them saying that, I think one of them had been particularly skeptical. MJ Kalkas was skeptical, but is happy to report that it was working. Both of them took videos. This was inspired a lot of excitement, this working storm drain.
Not having water in your yard apparently is a good thing.
It's a good thing.
And Mary Ann, did you want to say anything about?
Sure.
Duard's.
I'm just checking on my computer. I think.
It's that.
This is, yeah, I know.
Oh, okay.
It's this, but Duard is working on a website, and this, I was trying to see whether this was Facebook or a website, but I think this is what the website is going to look like.
I think it may be a brochure, though, because that's the reason he has the QR code.
Yeah, it is a brochure, but this is, he is working on a website that will have these.
And it'll be clickable.
Have these, yeah, different things like local food, low footprint food and agriculture. You can click on, you'll be able to click on different things and find out who's doing what and things like that.
Great.
Great.
Thanks, Mary Ann.
Yep.
We'll move on to public hearings and legislation. First, we have emergency reading of ordinance 2015-12. Judy, would you read that into the record by title only, please?
Yes, ordinance 2015-11 is authorizing and directing the submission to a vote of the electors of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, a proposal to amend certain provisions of the Charter of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, to be voted on at the next regular municipal election on November 3rd, 2015, and declaring an emergency.
Okay, two things can I get a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. First thing I want to note is that this is an amended ordinance to the one that was in the packet. Council did have this at the table. And Judy, could you cite what the difference is?
Yeah, the difference is that in Section 6, the version that most folks have seen stated that if the charter amendment passes, it would go into effect on January 1st. And we realized that because we are out of compliance on the swearing-in date for council members, it needs to go into effect as soon as the vote count is certified. So language to that effect has been put into Section 6.
Okay. So it didn't. It was only the ordinance language itself that changed.
Correct.
Okay.
Can I ask a practical question about that? Does that mean that, because I am not planning to run, as many people know, so that means that my current term will end on January 1st?
That is
December 31st. December 31st. Got it. Okay.
We're just giving you that extra time.
That's extra three meetings. I am, obviously.
Budget.
Okay.
Budget.
Just getting used to that idea.
So what this is about, and I think actually it might be good just to have, since well, either Brian or Jerry to discuss this, do a brief review of the charter review process and exactly what we are looking at. Then there are, I think, things that we need to discuss after that as far as whether this is going to be one ballot item, whether it's going to be multiple. So maybe we just should go through, review again what is, what the process was and what we're actually voting to change.
Okay.
Which one of you would?
I'll pass it over to Brian.
Okay. Okay.
So I think by way of background, we decided that there were some important suggestions for changes to our village charter, which I've mentioned before is sort of the constitution of the village that we need to abide by for any ordinances that we pass. And one of the things we realized is that there were some areas that were not so clear, especially when the initiative referendum issues came up. So that was one driver for doing this. There were also quite a few typographical errors, and that's the majority of the changes that were made. But when we really look at the other changes, although we've made classifications of conformance, meaning conforming to Ohio law, as well as substantive, the bottom line is the changes that we made really are primarily conformance if they're not typographical. So, for example, the reference to when we swear in our new council members, we realized that we were doing that too soon before the official vote count was made. We also noticed some things related to residency requirements. So those suggestions don't really substantively change very much in the way that our charter looks, but they are important to make sure that we do conform with the law and that there's clarity. We had 11 people on the Charter Review Committee, which met for 4 months. We had 9 meetings. And 2 meetings ago, we were presented with those recommendations. Council agreed with the recommendations from the Charter Review Committee. And what we're looking at now then is passing an ordinance, because these kinds of changes do need to be on the ballot and need to be voted on by the electors. So as Karen mentioned at this point, I think we do need to figure out whether we're going to look at one ballot initiative. We can separate certain changes or recommendations so there can be more than one thing to vote on. And I think that's a pretty good summary.
Okay. The other thing to note is that this is an emergency ordinance, which means it can mean one of two things. The first thing it means is that it is goes into effect immediately upon passage, rather than 30 days after passage, as is typical for a non-emergency ordinance. The second means that we can choose to have a single reading and then have it go into effect. At the last meeting, I think, because at the June, and you weren't here, at the June 15th meeting, there was some thought that maybe we would do two readings. We wanted to leave ourselves the option of doing a second reading at the July 17th meeting if we, whatever that date is, I don't know.
20th.
July 20th meeting, if we felt it necessary. So that's one of the another of the choices that need to be made tonight, if we're comfortable with a single reading and a vote, or if we want to do two readings. I think we were pretty explicit what we were planning to do. I don't see a lot of, you know, we'll obviously hear from the citizens, especially if we decide to do it as a single reading. We will have a formal public hearing. Mm-hmm. So I think that the items that we had discussed as being potentially ones that we would want to pull out, I think one of the specific ones was related to the residency of the village manager, because that was changed from within the village or a 5-mile radius to a neighboring county, is my understanding.
Right, so in Greene County or in adjacent county.
Right, so which is in conformance with Ohio law. We cannot enforce anything other than that. We could have different, and we do have with this manager, have different contractual requirements for her residency, but charter cannot control those. So we wanted it to have that to comply with state law, but it still might, with the concern of citizens that people that work for the village live in the village, I think that there is a thought that it will be a potentially controversial issue where people will be confused by it. So that would be the first one I would suggest we would potentially consider pulling out. Discussion about that?
Well, my inclination would be to have one
ballot initiative.
one, vote on one thing. I don't think any of the things that we're thinking of as controversial are truly controversial, because, as you said, we are just going, we are adapting to what exists in state law. So my inclination would be to have a really strong educational campaign to let people know why these changes are being made.
Mm-hmm. And we learned from...
I'm not going to, you know, put up a big fight about it, but that would be my inclination. Mm-hmm.
And we learned from Chris, our solicitor, that we can provide educational materials. We can't campaign for it, but we can, as the village government, provide educational information to voters. Another one that I would like to address, because I was approached by a citizen about it, is the provision regarding planning commission. Mm-hmm. With the request from Matt Reed at who is the chair of planning commission, that we reconsider that. His concern is that we maintain a relationship, a strong relationship with Miami Township. And, you know, I explained to him that it wasn't saying that we wouldn't have a Miami Township resident on planning commission. It just gave us the flexibility because of the fact that we had had difficulty filling the position. I also told him that I felt that relationship was really at possibly a different level, that it really was between elected officials. And the way township zoning works, their township zoning board doesn't really have much communication with their township trustees anyway. So, I think that he is still somewhat concerned, but I think he understands that as you know, as long as there is an interested party and that's the will of council, that we would have a Miami Township representative. Lori, do you have any comments?
No, I was one of the ones who suggested that we change it to the requirement. Because I have heard over the years people expressing some discomfort about having somebody who doesn't even live in the village potentially even chairing that commission, that strikes some people as odd, because the planning is for internally planning the village, and so there's that tug in the other
right.
direction. So I feel like what we are proposing is a pretty good compromise. It says we can have people from outside the village, but we're not required to fill that spot. We had a person who really wanted to end his term, who we kind of kept keeping on the commission because we couldn't find somebody from the township to fill that role. And we did find somebody eventually, but it took quite a bit of effort, so.
And the other thing I would say is that Matt's concern came out of issues that have been happening in neighboring townships and neighboring communities with annexation, and just feeling like that relationship is incredibly important. And mm-hmm. and again, I agree with him completely, but I think that the level of the relationship is at the level of elected officials as opposed to that planning commission level.
I want to endorse Marianne's position. I think I support her idea that I think I'm inclined also to put our emphasis on an educational campaign and not split it out into multiple ballot items.
Jerry?
I agree also. Just one, and it's up to us to educate the rest of the community. I'd hate to pull one out that legally we can't do it, but the voters mm-hmm. voted now,
mm-hmm.
and then we're in mm-hmm. quagmire. So, but I think if we do a good job of explaining why the changes are, I don't think the voters will have a problem.
Brian.
Yeah, I'm gonna present the other side. I could go either way, but I think the first sort of reality that I confront is that regardless of how much effort we put forward to educate The reality is a lot of people just are not engaged in what we're doing at council table, and I'm not sure that we would have that impact. So the risk to me is some of these changes, like when we swear in new council members, if that doesn't pass, then I find that to be a real problem. Whereas if the initiative about residency, if that did fail, then, I mean, it wouldn't matter because legally we can't require the village manager to live here. So I'm concerned about all the work that was done if one issue would lead to that not passing as a whole. Then we're going to be stuck with certain things. And Planning Commission is another one that puts me in a quandary, because if we can't meet that obligation of the required township member, then what? How does Planning Commission move forward? So I love the idea of one ballot initiative, but I think it would be more problematic if the other 99% didn't pass. And that's why I want us to just be aware of that. So.
Well, the Planning Commission one, I can definitely speak to. It's solved for the for at least the 3-year term of our current person, from assuming she doesn't move, right?
Right.
That's the other issue, is you can appoint somebody and at the time they live in the township, but they of course have the right at any time to move and move into the village. So assuming she doesn't move, we've got somebody on board who is committed to the work and excellent. I don't know why I didn't think of her earlier and reach out to her. But so for the least the next 3 years, we're okay on the Planning Commission. So I certainly wouldn't pull that one out.
Right.
Your argument about the village manager one is a little bit, is a stronger one.
Yeah, that's the one I'm most concerned with.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I just think there's a risk there, and I guess I'm willing to go with the majority, but
we can put it back on the ballot in May too. You know, we can.
And swear in the council according
to
the
charter.
Yeah, well,
Chris, that's the one that is that I think is the biggest issue. Is there something else we can do if for some reason this thing doesn't pass? I mean, that seems like.
I think that we could pass another ordinance and get it back on the ballot in May.
But as Lori said, the swearing in of the council member. We've been doing it for however long against state law.
What I think that we could do as a practical matter is simply ask those individuals who were elected to wait until the election certified before we formally swear them in. If they do that voluntarily, and council can move forward. I mean, it's not an ideal situation, but now that we're aware of it, I think we have an obligation to work around with it so that we can comply with the law. It's pick the devil you're with in some ways. But I would be comfortable with that.
Again, would you remind us of what the ballot will look like? Will the ballot just be all black letters? I mean, we won't have red lines. We will have.
You'll have strike.
It will have strike through.
Yeah, I think it'll all be in one color, but there will be strike throughs and then bold language that would show what the changes are. The language that appears on the top of Exhibit A would be how the issues presented to the voters, presumably simply yes and no. The Board of Elections will review that document as they've done in the past with the initiative. They'll work with Judy as the clerk to get all of the timing and then the notices out. And then we'll get on the ballot. And I've already notified the Board of Elections that we've got the charter amendments that the council is considering passing that ordinance. So they're kind of waiting on us. And whether you take the vote today or on July 20th, we have time to get it to that. I mean, today gives us a little more time just to do vacation schedules and everything else. But if you chose to make it one document, yes or no, in its entirety, and it failed, if you had a sense of why it failed, the newly constituted council, or the old council for that matter, could put it back on the next election ballot.
Okay. Thanks, Chris.
And I, if I can.
I want to add one other thing to clarify. On the issue of the educating the electorate, that there's two parts to that. One is elected officials. You can individually endorse a position as it pertains to your view of what should happen or how you may view the amendments themselves. The issue of the village's official position has to do with the expenditure of money. If the village determines to expend money, it can only be done to educate the voters on the issue.
Right. It can't endorse it.
Correct.
Right.
But individually, you could write your own letters endorsing the action. So.
Okay. Thanks, Chris. Judy?
I was just going to say that it makes things, I think, less precarious if it's passed tonight, just because I leave 2 days after it would pass for vacation, and it would make me a lot happier if I had time to screw it up and then fix it if I needed to. But that's just me.
So let's decide on those two things. It sounds like, unless anybody was persuaded from Brian's argument, that we're...
Well, before we do finish that, I want to make sure from Patty and Judy that there aren't any other issues that, if this initiative didn't pass, would be a problem.
As far as I can recall back to all the meetings, the biggest one would be, the swearing in that we talked about, and how that would affect the budget process, potentially affect the budget process. I can't really think of any other.
No, that was the big one.
Okay.
Jerry, were you going to say something?
Yeah. You know, we tout ourselves as being an educated community, and to me, we've got two issues that basically talk about the law, and and I think if we make it real clear that number one, we can't force someone to live in the community, and number two, we can't swear in officers before the votes are certified. To me, that's real simple, and that's why I'm inclined to go along with Mary Ann and Lori to say just one packet. Because my concern is when you pull something out, then people get suspicious as to why did they pull these two things out when the law says you got to comply with them. So that's...
Mm-hmm. I mean, that's definitely my inclination. My desire is to just go with the one ballot initiative. So
there's one other issue we have to talk about, I guess, which is what we're going to do with the recall sections, because we have two versions in the packet. So whether we're going to make some of those broad sweeping changes that clarify and take out a couple amendments, a couple sections, or if we're going to leave it as is.
Can you remind us where that is?
72.
Got it. Yeah, 72.
Now, and remember, the reasoning behind this.
72 and 73.
Right. The reasoning behind this was that just as we clarified initiative and referendum, the idea of clarifying recall, the reason for not making those changes was, again, potential confusion for voters.
Right. Mine doesn't have to. I mean, where?
Yeah, it was in the online.
My packet didn't have it either, but the original that I
presented. Online, it showed the two.
There's two versions of the
right.
Exhibit,
there's two,
I think.
Online.
The
That's
second,
right.
The
there
second
are
version
there
has
two.
The recall, section 72.
So the first version has just like clarifying language. The second version changes it to just repeal sections 73 and 74 altogether. And under 72 just says the procedure for such recall shall be that provided in the Ohio Revised Code.
This is on the website.
I personally would like to go ahead with this more drastic in some ways version of just saying follow the procedure in the Ohio Revised Code. because I think it's less confusing for citizens, and it makes the charter less likely to get out of compliance with Ohio Revised Code if they make a change, then we're right with them. And citizens know, if I want to recall somebody, there's one-stop shopping. I go to the Ohio Revised Code as opposed to looking at the charter, and then if somebody says, but wait, the Ohio Revised Code says this, then they're confused, and potentially there could be grounds for undercutting a legitimate recall election because the Ohio Revised Code says one thing and our code says another thing. So I am inclined to support this more major revision, which is changing Section 72 to saying the procedure shall be followed, that provided in the Ohio Revised Code, and repealing Section 73 and 74.
And would you still want to keep that as one, under one ballot initiative?
I think I still would. But I'm glad you called our attention to it. I'd forgotten about that.
Here it is.
But I think it really does make it simpler for citizens, and it makes it less likely that a legitimate recall referendum, you know, I can't think of, there's a perfect word out there that I can't think of. But anyway,
would be challenged.
And right. So it hurts citizens' rights to have a complex code of our own.
Right.
And which is one of the reasons that we did it in the first place. It was the referendum language that was so complicated and
it was confusing for the citizens who wanted to do a referendum because they didn't know exactly what to follow. So I think that one will be, again, pretty easy to educate on, as Jerry said. I think we can do it. And as you say, if the whole thing fails because we haven't done a good enough job of educating, it sounds like we can muddle it through and put it on
try
the main
again, right.
ballot and try again. At that time, then we feel like, well, we need to split some of these things out to figure out why it's failing. Then we do that at that time,
right.
Or we do better education.
Yeah, and just to be clear, I'm very comfortable with one ballot initiative. I just want us to, you know, be aware of the risks, and as long as they're not that great, then I'm okay.
So, do we need is this amendment we've been presented clear enough? What we want to do? You want to say something?
Well, I was, but one of the things I was going to say is I just want to reiterate what Brian has said is that. Is the lawyer, Amy Blankenship, and I were the legal counsel for the Charter Review Committee, and our mission was to review the charter to make sure that we were correcting those typographical errors, conformance changes, compliance changes. The intent of every proposed amendment is not to change the substance of how the Village of Yellow Springs government and its council functions or operates. It was intended, as you pointed out, Lori, any change that's put forth on the ballot is designed to make it easy for the people here to look at that charter as the governing document of this of the government and the community and read it and understand it. And so to the extent that, a quote from me gets in the paper, it says, there's not an intention here to change anything substantively of how the village functions. And I think that message is reiterated over and over again. I think people won't have any trouble voting for the changes because it makes practical sense.
Thank you, Chris. So do we have a completely intact Exhibit A?
Yes.
That is doing...
I only have one.
Have not seen this, whatever
well,
the second one is.
I think the confusion might be between referendum and recall. Because the online version has the referendum section, which is Section 70, and then the recall section, which starts in Section 72.
It looks like we missed a page. A page got missed.
Mm-hmm. Can
a
I
page
go,
got missed
want me
in
to
my
go
packet.
Reprint no. this while you continue? Because
I go from Section 70 to Section 73.
Okay, yeah, you're missing this page right here.
That's how mine goes also.
Okay, because I have the online version, and mine is complete.
Yeah, mine is complete as well.
That's why I was confused what we were talking about, because it's...
Yeah, I feel like I need to see the, so let's table, I don't, table this and maybe move on to a couple of other votes, a couple of other discussions. Can we do that, Mrs. Council?
Yeah.
Okay. Next piece of legislation is Resolution 2015, approving a contract for utility line clearing for 2015.
And Judy just ran...
Oh, Judy's not here. Okay, never...
Here, I can, you want me to read it by title?
Yeah, sure.
Authorizing the village manager to enter into an agreement with ArborCare for 2015 utility line clearance, Section 2 of the village.
Thank you. Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Patty or Johnny?
Johnny, do you want to do it? Okay. This is our standard contract with ArborCare for our annual utility line clearance. The reason it says Section 2 is because the village is divided into sections, and that is the section that we are doing this year. We did get only one bid, correct? No, we got two bids. And ArborCare was the lowest bid at $92,000, and they have done the village's utility line clearing for 5 years? 5 years. So if you have any other questions...
And could you, Section 2, that's what I was going to ask.
Johnny?
Section 2 is from Allen Street to like Limestone, this area.
Okay, so up.
From Xenia over to Corey.
And as usual, citizens, will citizens be notified? Okay. And when do you think, when's the work going to start?
I need to talk to him probably no earlier than August.
Okay.
Something like that.
Okay.
Are there, because this, so this is $92,000, and we're kind of, we're, right now, I think we're doing cutting on the trees every year, is that right?
In a different section.
In a different section. We're just working around the four sections. And obviously, I think this is about half of what we've had in the past, because for a while, I don't think we were really doing it. We...
I know that it's been going on for 5 years.
Yeah.
This is our sixth year, so we're in the Section 2.
Again.
So this is on the second cut in the cycle.
Right. I guess what I'm wondering is, because it's a large amount of money, in how much it would cost to bury, not every line, because that would be impossible and too expensive, but I'm wondering if there are key lines that are, end up being the bulk of the expense every year that we could even look at burying, because they're so shrouded in trees?
The problem is with Yellow Springs with all the limestone, we would spend more time in maintaining, trying to maintenance underground.
Oh, because of the...
The rock and the tree roots and all that.
Okay.
It'd be worse.
All right. You think it would be worse?
Yes.
Okay. Well, that's actually very helpful, because people have asked me about that before, and I guess I've always thought it was just the expense of it. Thanks.
But we are on all new development.
All new development is in conduit, and all the water is underground.
And obviously, that's been, that was a big focus of the streetscape project on Xenia Avenue downtown, to get those wires underground.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay.
Should the...
I said it should be 2. I'm assuming it should be Section 2.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Well, yeah, I guess I have a question, Johnny.
Okay.
If we're doing underground for new development, are we going to run into the same kind of problems you're suggesting we would run into in the older part of town?
When it's installed, I was not here when it was installed, so hopefully they made the preparation and didn't let them bury back the rock. But in order to do it, like on the main power lines, you would almost have to directional board in, or you'd be tearing everybody's yard up and going down through the property lines, and that, you'd have to truck in.
And it'd be hard, it's harder with all the mature trees most of the time in new development.
The new developments, they're flat, they've brought in dirt, they've brought in fill, they've taken all the rock out, like that hotel took out all that limestone jackhammer, and now they're putting in like 70 tons of rock just to build building back up. Actually, more than that, it's like 7,000.
And also with downtown, they did a bunch of jackhammering to get it the way they should.
Thanks.
Council, are we ready to take a vote? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, so we have the proper charter amendment, Exhibit A from Judy. I think maybe Jerry and I were the only ones that didn't, weren't aware that there was a problem, or didn't have the correct one.
I did. So if you look at 70, you see just.
Right, so 70.
Just minor wording changes, and then 72 is where the major change happens, and 73 and 74 are gone.
Section 75 applies to recall. That section would be changed in either scenario.
Right.
Okay. So I agree, I personally agree with Lori that, I do prefer maintaining, trying to get things as consistent as possible, which we've done the same thing really with referendum, so to do it with recall makes sense to me, and to reduce the amount of changes we might have in the future. I would support the adding the Section 2 changes and repealing Sections 73 and 74. Is everyone in agreement with that? Should we take a, do a motion on that, or are we okay with this? Well, no, I mean, we'll do a motion for the whole thing, but I.
I don't think you need to, because we present two alternatives to A. If the motion includes the language to adopt,
okay.
Motion has to recall,
okay.
I think that's good enough.
Okay. So I guess that, so I would suggest that the motion that we're going to vote on would be to include this, the change to recall, that would have it all as a single ballot initiative, and that we do this as an emergency with a single reading, and that single vote will be tonight.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So
yes.
Move.
Okay. Second.
Okay. And so those are, you are approving the changes to Sections 71, 72, 73, the Exhibit A that includes the substantial changes to 71, 2, 3.
Right. Yes.
Yes. And 4, because Section 74 would also be repealed.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And I on the issue of educating the public, I'm wondering if it's your perception that it would be, that we could possibly contact the people who served on this committee and find out if any of them would be willing to help with doing some educational outreach,
yes.
Since they're so familiar with
yes.
what we did.
I think so, and we did talk about that in our last couple meetings, that
okay.
that would potentially be a role to play. So I think everybody that was involved would be happy to do that.
Okay, and it wouldn't come as a, wait, I thought we were done.
Well, there might be a few.
For some people, yeah.
But in general, yeah, okay. I think.
If we have something together by the time of the neighborhood picnics.
Oh, the block parties?
Block mm-hmm. parties, we could have things to pass out then.
Okay. So
I've got a question for Chris. Is it acceptable to send out educational materials along with the required letter to every citizen describing the ballot initiative?
Mm-hmm. My initial reaction is yes, but I think that we would need to look into that when we talk to the Board of Elections about the process.
Okay, thank you. We are, this is a first reading, first and final reading, and we will have a public hearing, so I will open the public hearing for citizen comments on this ordinance. Seeing and hearing none, I'll,
question.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
Go ahead.
I'm driving us into the crowd. I still don't have the updated one, I think. The
here, where did those?
Is there an extra?
Okay.
Yeah.
So you're suggesting to repeal all of
here.
74, so there's nothing there anymore.
Right. Correct.
Okay.
Because,
yes.
Yeah, it all comes down to go see the Ohio Revised Code. So We're taking that all out because it would no longer be necessary to describe it.
Okay, and 74 is still there as I have it. So, I mean, 70 is still there as I have it.
Correct.
Yes. The referendum process has just been tweaked and clarified. It's the recall process.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, I think those were extra copies, yes.
Correct, yes.
And again, I think at the end of the day, it's all about just go to one place because ultimately we have to, you know, conform with Ohio law.
Dan, go ahead.
Yes.
Dan Rains. I have a question, and it maybe goes to what Brian was saying about the simplicity or complexity of doing public education with these different initiatives. And I don't know that, I think I understand what you're saying, that this is a fairly straightforward change with the rescinding of certain sections and referring over to the unified code. Although, I wonder if the presentation for that on the ballot is a bit different. It presents a different educational challenge. For instance, if one is reading a ballot that describes the rescinding of certain sections, will you be able to present the applicable parts of the Ohio Revised Code that would be the exchange, in a sense, for those sections that have been rescinded?
That would have to be within the educational process. The ballot can only contain what the Board of Elections allows it to contain.
And I guess I'm not trying to talk you into either direction on this myself, but just calling that out, that it is a different challenge. And if you think that you're up to doing it, the communication to make that clear and to make everyone feel comfortable with what is being switched for what, then go for it. But if not, that would be a reason to perhaps consider that section, that item, a little differently.
Okay, thanks, Dan. Are we ready to take a vote? Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Sims?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes.
Asplund?
Yes.
Okay. Next item on the agenda is Resolution 2015-22, by title only.
Yes, this is authorizing the village manager to enter into a contract with GM Pipeline for the bottleneck elimination project.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
take your pick.
So I don't know if Patty, is that you? Going to be you or?
Well, Johnny and I will kind of tag team this one.
Okay.
Council has in your packet, I included it in the last packet, a bit of an educational piece about this project, how it was bid as an alternate bid along with the loop completion project, and why we need to go ahead with it now, and also about how it would be funded and what would be necessary to fund it. The one piece of information that you don't have that's in there is that we were in fact approved for the loan for the loop completion, and we will be getting that $405,000 back to go into the general fund, and it will be repaid out of the water revenues, which Melissa will cover during her presentation. This would be the same plan to pay for the bottleneck elimination project in the same way via a loan, pay it out of the general fund, and then put it right back in as soon as the loan comes in, and it would be done by the end of the year. So essentially, it would be a wash for the end of the year and included in the projection for the needed revenues for the water fund that Melissa will go over. Now I'll let Johnny explain the project to you and what it encompasses.
We will essentially take a 12-inch water main from Herman Street to Cahoe, and it will run the side of 68 or the side of Zinni Avenue. With that process...
Which side?
It will be on the east side. With that process, all the house services, meters, water meters that are inside will be moved outside at the same time, and they will all have new meters installed going down 68 to where nobody has to go in the houses.
And so the meters on both sides?
The meters on both sides.
Both sides of 68.
From Herman to Cahoe, all those residents down there will get brand new meters, and they'll be outside.
And while they won't be radio read now, they will be able to be converted to radio read with an antenna when we get that to that point, correct?
And could you discuss schedule?
They will not be able to start this until October.
Okay.
Because they've got projects in front of us, but they would like to put it right after one of their larger projects that they're getting ready to start. So it gives us a little time. They're in the process of doing the restoration now, and then they'll leave, and then we get mobilized.
So it would be like the third week of October, sometime mid to late October?
Probably mid-October.
And if there's bad weather, it would have to get pushed to spring, I assume.
I don't know that you're going to slow these guys down with bad weather.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
They've got the equipment to be able to do it, I mean.
It's a little bit, it's a bigger project, but it's a little bit simpler than the late completion.
Asphalt plants?
The asphalt, we won't be disturbing the asphalt.
Oh, really?
Except for the crossovers.
Okay.
For the different streets. I have talked to them about taking where we had planned on putting the blacktop back and doing concrete, and they said that they would work with us with that. In front of the residents there from Herman to Brookside.
You mean where the bike path is?
Where the bike path is. But down on the lower part.
Right.
We want to be going down there with the water line will stay up top.
Right, so basically from Allen.
So it's still in the grass?
It will be on the side of the road.
Yeah, on the side of the road.
So essentially from Allen to Herman is where the sidewalks would be replaced. The asphalt would be replaced with sidewalks.
Correct.
That's, I mean, I think that's a great part of the project. That's the kind of thing I think we need. I think it's the worst sidewalk in town.
Yeah.
I walked on it an awful lot, so.
Yeah.
And I think it's the kind of thing we need to be doing. We need to be piggybacking projects. When we're doing a street project, we need to, you know, do the sidewalks and curbs if it makes sense. So I'm glad, do the water lines if it makes sense. So I'm glad that we're looking forward and thinking about it that way. And I, you know, I've been impressed with GM. I mean, they worked that other project incredibly well. So I can only, I trust them when they say they're going to push this project also. You know,
go ahead.
I was just going to say, there's like, anyway, they want to get done.
Right.
And that's the thing, that's what's good about having a company that's busy. They want to get done with every project as quickly as possible so they can move on to the next one.
Right. And you've been pleased working with them?
Yes.
Good.
Any other questions or comments, council? Citizens, questions or comments?
Johnny, you were saying that they won't have to cut across Xenia Avenue like they did.
Everything going across Xenia Avenue will be directional board.
Okay. Other than.
Because that'd be just service lines.
Okay, okay.
Right now, the tap, we've already got the tap in to hook onto the 12-inch and go down Xenia Avenue.
Yeah, I think what Johnny was talking about when we were talking about the asphalt was where we have to go, like across Woodrow. That's it, right? Allen. Woodrow, Allen, Brookside, and on down.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm going to ask, so the project we just finished, the loop completion, that was what took the line, the larger line, up to the water towers. So now we're basically just hooking a bigger line into that line that's going east to west at Herman.
Right, coming into town from the fields.
There's a 10-inch at Cahoe now, and there's a 10-inch at Herman. We just have to connect the two 10-inches, and that's being done by 12-inch.
And right now, that the two 10-inches are connected by a 6?
A 6 and a 4.
Yeah.
Well, and I think it's also, it's important to reiterate the reason we're doing this is to improve fire flow for the citizens, all of the citizens south of Herman. YSI has requested it as our largest business customer. They have requested it. Friends Care Center, it's going to do wonders for Friends Care Center. So it's an economic development and it's a public safety issue. So it's an important project.
And council does need to understand that it will require the rate increase.
Yes.
Additional rate increase.
Right.
So if the project doesn't start until October, I mean, it depends on when we take the loan. The loan payments on OWDA are due in January and July. So it depends on when we take that actual payment on that. when we would actually start making the debt payments. We'll start making the debt payment on the loop completion in January.
Okay.
Part of the thing I iterate is, I say they bad weather don't stop them. It actually shuts them down. They don't work. They'll actually lay their guys off. And our guys are used to it. They say they only work 7 months out of the year because of that. But they all look forward to having the winter off.
But they want to get as many, they want as many jobs in before they do that.
And given the schedule on the loop completion, I don't see that this is going to be, as you said, it's straight down.
Right.
I mean, I guess the concern I might have, and I don't want to belabor this, would be the concrete sidewalk, though.
If they need to, they could come back in the spring, early spring, and we'll finish that.
Okay. Council, ready to take a vote? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Last, we have Resolution 2015-23 regarding the tax budget. Judy?
Yes, and this is approving the Finance Director's 2016 tax budget for the Village of Yellow Springs.
Thank you. Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, and Melissa is here to discuss this. Thank you.
Okay, what I included in the packet, the first page is a sheet that says Finance Director's Notes for the 2016 Tax Budget. It just basically explains the process and why we do this and where this kind of comes from. This is all initiated by the County Auditor. They send over a three-page document which includes our property tax amounts that are collected for the next year, inside and outside the 10 mil limitation. And this includes, it splits it into general fund and police pension, and this isn't actually in the packet, but this is just where just a few of the figures come from. They only give me two figures. The property taxes total that we will collect next year that's expected is $981,000. 222 of that are inside the 10 mil limitation, and 759,000 of that is outside the 10 mil limitation, which is a product of the levy. So that's how much the levy provides, is 759,000 out of the 981 that we've received. So it's very significant. And then it also provides 29,000 that goes to our police pension fund. So they outline that. That's all that they give me for inclusion in the tax budget. And what the tax budget does is it's the first exercise in the budget, and it basically is used as our first certificate of estimated resources for next year. So it tells us what revenues, well, we tell them what revenues we might expect to receive on top of the property taxes, the figures that they already give us. So since we do our budget and we file that by the first of the year, this services our first estimated resource, certificate of estimated resources that tells them that we're not spending more than what we have. So the document that follows, it's a seven-page document, but we only use five of the 7 pages because two of those pages we didn't have anything to be included. So what we look at on the first page, these are the revenues for the general fund.
I'm sorry, I don't have hardly any of, I have 2 pages is all I've been given. Judy?
Same here. Yep, I have a printing issue. Come on.
Okay, so we've got the tax budget. In the very first page, what we have, actually, let me skip around to the document that Karen does have while Judy's doing that. I tried to do a Cliff Notes version. It's this Excel spreadsheet that's kind of colorful.
Mm-hmm.
I did notice when I was sitting there that the last thing that I did, I had a few omissions. But this is what we started the beginning of 2015 with. I gave all of the balances of all of the funds. And then I have where I project that we're going to end 2015 and then begin 2016. And then I've got the end of 2016's projection and then a projected ending balance in 2016 based on the figures that are included in the tax budget. And I also have a column off to the far right of recommended minimum reserves. The guidelines are usually 3 months worth of minimum reserves that we should have, but I figured in for 4 months just because that made me a little bit more comfortable. So
So if you look at the recommended minimum reserves, I took that off of our 2015 operating costs. And we are in line for the most part, and will be in line for the most part for all of our major funds at the end of 2016. With the exception of the sewer fund, will be a little bit low. The water fund will be a little bit high, and then the electric fund is still maintaining a healthy balance. I highlighted in green for those end of 2016 projections for the enterprise funds where we might end the year, and those are including 15% rate increases in each of our enterprise funds. We have the rate study that is, well, the rate studies are still kind of going on, and some of the these projections were based on some of the data from the rate studies. So it's actually kind of a middle of the road approach. Some of them were asking for higher rate increases, and the water fund will likely need a larger increase than the 15% because of the new water plant. But for tax budget purposes, I don't have anything in there for the new water plant just because it's too early in the game at this point to know.
But you did include both of the debt payments for the loop completion and the bottleneck in these figures.
Full year. So if we did a 15% water rate increase in 16, we would be adding $91,000, almost $92,000 to the fund balance at the end of 2015, the beginning of 2016. So we would actually end the year with approximately $428,000. And that's including those two debt service payments on the loop and the bottleneck, loop completion and bottleneck. So that's just kind of the Reader's Digest version. The only thing that I omitted that I realized as I was sitting here this evening is what we did, Patty and I decided that we wanted to actually revitalize. I couldn't find any history on some of these funds, but the capital improvement funds, which are kind of in the middle of the page, there's never been any money put into the water, the sewer, or the electric. The parks and the facilities and the capital equipment, there was some money moved in there from the initial levy that was passed. And we decided this year for 2016, since the general fund is, you know, in a comfortable range, considering if all projections are the way that I see them now, with the first 5 months of spending that we've had, because I wasn't able to get the figures from June and even here in this time. We were going to move $500,000 from the electric fund into a capital improvement, into the electric improvement fund, which is why the electric funds got such a deficit projection for the end of 2016, because we wanted to move some of that fund balance into the capital.
Does everybody, just to make sure everybody does understand the capital as opposed to operating and how they're normally both exist on a...
Yeah.
Okay.
No, I think that makes sense.
It's just a better way to earmark money versus dipping into our operating, because what we've done in the last few years is we were dipping into our operating to pay for some of our capital, and it appeared that we were deficit spending, and it was kind of confusing because we were deficit spending, but it wasn't necessarily because of operating, it was because of capital.
Right, right.
So this makes it a little bit cleaner to move some of the surpluses into those capital improvement funds, and then we know kind of what we have to work with, and it doesn't look like those particular funds are deficit spending in terms of operation.
So is that why the end of 2016 projection is a pretty minimal 26,000 in at the very top general fund and end of 2016?
That's a deficit of
that. Yeah, that would be the deficit for
but
that
it's
fund,
a,
but that
it's a considerably
means,
smaller
yes
and it looks pretty good to me. So
well, I did some creative things with transferring money out to the streets and the parks. Normally the streets and the parks, those two funds, they have very little money that come in and support them, and most of their support comes from transfers from the general fund. But because of spending that has been a little more conservative over the last couple of years, their fund balances have built up a little bit. Mm-hmm. So I was taking the minimum amount out of the general fund in order to be able to support those funds for the year and still maintain a healthy reserve of 4 months worth of operating.
Great.
So it was some creativity, and we were still able to move $150,000 out of the general fund to put into the Parks and Rec Improvement, Facilities Improvement, and Capital Equipment Funds as well. So I feel a little bit better about this budget this year, but then again, the levy is very important, a very important factor in this is it's providing, you know, 3/4 of our levy dollars.
And this budget includes no capital projects.
Right. Can we change the word improvement to capital?
Mm-hmm.
Because I think it makes, that's a term everybody understands.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Where, are you showing the capital improvement or capital?
They're called improvement funds. It says water improvement, sewer improvement.
Electrical.
It doesn't say.
Enterprise funds.
Oh, yeah, okay, it's not a separate column.
Yeah, and those transfers out, I didn't have included for the end of 2016 projection because that was the general fund and enterprise funds, you know, were where I focused everything. And I had the money moving out, but I didn't have it being put in this projection sheet. I did this at the very last minute on Thursday.
And also, Melissa, perhaps it would help if you put electric operating, water operating. It would make one capital, make the other one say operating. That might.
So electric operating fund.
Right, you'll have electric operating and electric capital, and that may make those two a little bit more clear mm-hmm. for
yeah,
exactly what they
idea.
Are.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea.
And facilities, just that is the Bryan Center, that's the library, I assume that's the
train station.
Sutton Farm.
And that's the big hit to that was the library roof.
Right.
We had quite a bit of money and then we're spending that down to almost nothing. So moving some more money in there for anything that happens, like the boiler
any
that went down at Bryan Center, it would have been really nice if we would have been able to tap into that to be able to cover the cost of that.
Mm-hmm. Melissa, I have a question that actually comes out of the charter review process because I noticed in the charter it says that our budget is supposed to have 5-year capital expense projection. Do we do that?
We did so much purchasing of capital in the 2014 budget that everybody's pretty much set right now.
Right.
In terms of thinking forward in putting away money for needed repairs that could happen in 20 years or so, we really do need to get a plan. And we would have to work with the superintendents, Patty and myself, to really do that.
And part of that is going to be included in the rate study, particularly for the water and the sewer. Because that is part of Wayne's projected rate increases is where those things will be over the next several years.
I mean, given that our charter says we're supposed to do it.
And I also have to do one for every OPWC grant. So I'm actually updating one right now for the grant application that will be, I have to get into OPWC by the 17th, I believe. So we do have one. It's not in the budget. And once I get it updated, I certainly can provide it to council. That's not a problem.
It's certainly been my recollection, though, that we've done that in the last mm-hmm. budget cycles.
Mm-hmm.
This
yes.
is a tax budget, which is different.
I know. That's yeah. what I said. I know.
Yeah.
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 This is a
but
different thing.
But we've had it. In the last budget, we had it.
Okay.
We've had it in the last several budgets.
Yeah.
We've spent so much money on capital in the last 2 years that there was only 2 requests that were made. One of them was streetscape and one of them was a cruiser, and we didn't put either of those in there just so that you guys had a bare bones look at the budget.
And we do, yeah, and we do have a couple of other things that have come up since even I talked to Melissa on Thursday, but she and I will sit down and figure that out before we bring them to council as part of the budget.
Okay.
I thought it was best just for everybody to kind of look at what it costs to operate with the tax budget since there aren't any really huge projects on the table. So
yeah.
So I did do that Cliff Notes version, but we'll get through the actual tax budget. I'll just briefly explain some of these things. The very front page of the tax budget, it includes all of the revenues for the general fund. You'll notice that the estimate for the current year for 2015 is almost $500,000 higher than what it's been in past years, but because that includes the repayment of the loop completion project loan. The general fund paid it out and we're gonna receive it back in. So it kind of skews the figures for this year because it looks like we're doing really great, but part of that is just because we're getting paid back from that loan. So if you look at the very bottom at the total revenues, they pretty much stay fairly steady. So nothing,
I see what you're saying.
Nothing unexpected for 2016 or for 2015 for that matter. If we flip to the next page, page two, this is where we get into our expenditures. All the expenditures for the general fund are lumped together, except they make us take out the police department budget. So the police department budget is the only thing that you'll notice on page two.
So that's this
and
one.
The current year estimated for 2015, they're coming in quite a bit lower than what was budgeted. And the budget for 2016 looks like it's quite a bit higher, but really it's just in line with the exact same budget that was approved in 2015. It's just with them not expending as much money in 2015, they're on track to spend less than what they were budgeted for. So they were actually doing pretty good in that area for this year. Actually, everybody is. Everybody's on track to underspend their budgets by quite a bit. If we look at the third page, this is the general fund. And again, it gives 2 years worth of actuals. It gives an estimate for 2015 and an estimate for 2016. And at the end of this year, we're only going to cut into the general fund budget by approximately $150,000. At the beginning of the year, it was estimated that we were going to dip in about $1 million. So
yeah.
Part of that was because of the loop completion. We're getting
okay.
that money back in. I'm expecting that, and I didn't budget for that money coming back to the general fund in 2015 because we didn't know. So we in with the savings that we've been seeing across all departments, the general fund is looking to be a whole lot better than what was projected with the original budget. So we're only going to dip in about $150,000, and that was as of 5 months worth of expenditure. So I'm hoping that we stay on track there. So that's the general fund. It's got the transfers that are outlined out to the right. We do three transfers every year to the police pension fund, the parks fund, and the streets fund, and those are a lot lower than what they've been in years past, like I said, because their fund balances have built up a little bit. And then we've got that extra $150,000 going to those improvement funds, or capital funds, I should say. If we go to page four, this is the police pension fund. Part of the property taxes that were outlined in the document that the auditor sent over is included in this. And then the rest of the money that is used to pay for our police pensions are a result of a transfer out from the general fund into this fund. And I try to make it so that it nets out to zero every single year, so that fund balance basically stays the same. And then the next page, page number five, this is all of the special revenue and capital project funds. And this actually has the correct figures for those capital project funds that I did not make or did not include onto that Reader's Digest version that I provided. So if you look at the very far right, those are the estimated unencumbered fund balances for the end of 2016. So those are all in line with what we should have in terms of reserves for our expenditures. A lot of these funds are relatively inactive or smaller. The biggest ones are the streets and the parks funds that we have. The green space fund is also in here, and I did not include with the tax budget any kind of transfer out or any expenditures, just because I hadn't heard of any projects that were coming or how council feels about transferring some more money out to that, since it's got $145,000 in it, or will at the end of this year.
So and is that generally the philosophy with, like, if I compare page three, if there isn't a transfer, it's because that fund already can cover what it needs in 2016?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. I didn't have a transfer for the Widows Fund, which was only $1,500, just because that fund had built up a little bit, so
right.
I didn't do that. So I was trying to be conservative with our transfers, just because those are where the general fund takes a pretty huge hit every year.
And I noticed cable as well. You didn't have any. And cable, you also didn't have anything at this point.
Cable has, what is it, $10,550 in it, and it's been inactive.
Right.
So unless there's some sort of a plan that is brought to the table that would warrant a transfer or some expenditures in that area, I just didn't know about any, so I just kind of left it alone.
Yep.
Although I would say the Green Space Fund is one that has been intended to grow.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the original intent was that we would be adding $50,000 to that annually.
Mm-hmm.
I think, what did we decide to do this year? Did we
hold 25?
Well, nothing.
And we were going to expend 25. $5,000.
Right.
That was it.
Because prior to my arrival, it had been reduced to 25, and then last year during the budget cycle, we decided not to move anything because the only project that we had pending was the invasives removal right here behind the Bryan Center. So there was no transfer last year.
But the goal of that fund is to grow so that we do have money there if we want to contribute to easements. So I think we made a good decision for 2015, given what we had to work with. But it does show that you're budgeting again for, and I realize this, you know, we aren't discussing the budget, but I mean, that one is intended to build up.
Yes.
So we'll need to just think about that as we get into the budget cycle, what we want
right,
to do.
Right, and before I forget, because I will if I don't say this now that I'm thinking of it, one thing that council did also want to revisit in July was the additional 1% increase for the staff that we deferred.
All right.
So just since it was in my head, thought
so
I better
do
say
it. We would need to vote on that at the next meeting.
Well, you can discuss it. You can make it retroactive to the first. Melissa can address it as far as if it's in the budget right now or not. I believe she included it just in
case.
Yeah,
the original budget that was adopted, I had a 2% increase for the full year figured into it. And it was, I think, after very late in the game that council decided that they would just do the 1% and then revisit. So I had already budgeted for it for the full year, and everybody is still starting to come in way under what was budgeted. So unless, you know, the second half of the year is going to be really heavily loaded in expenditures, which I hope that doesn't happen, we're in really good shape right now. So,
and you don't see any huge expenses coming in on the horizon at the moment,
unless something just
obviously
completely falls apart. Yeah,
yeah,
I think we're okay.
I feel but so much better about this next budget cycle than what I ever have since I started. So,
oh, good.
This makes me feel a lot better than it does. It looks better. I mean, at the end of 2016, we're going to deficit spend in just a few of these funds, but it's because we're investing in other areas. We're investing in the capital funds, and we're moving money around, and we're using some of the reserves that are a little larger than what need to be. So it's, I feel a lot better about this one.
Okay. And we're investing in the community. I mean, mm-hmm. what we're putting our money into is stuff that has
right.
gone too long without being invested in. And
right.
so I'm really pleased. I can't believe how much more relieved I am going into this budget cycle.
Yeah.
So I want to make sure we send a real thanks to all the department mm-hmm. heads for all the hard work they've done. And I don't know if we can just vote on it tonight, but especially since it's already been budgeted, I'm totally in support of adding that additional 1% to all the staff who've had to sacrifice quite a bit in order to help make sure
we need a resolution.
Yeah, we'll have to.
Okay. Oh, it's an ordinance. So I've got that on agenda planning. So we'll talk about when we're going to do that.
Resolution.
Okay. Okay. So we've just got one more page, and that's page 6. That's the enterprise funds. This one's a little bit more succinct. If you look over to the far right, it's got all of our estimated unencumbered fund balances through the end of 2016. Keep in mind that these figures do include 15% rate increases for all three of the enterprise funds, not solid waste, just electric, water, and sewer. And like we talked about earlier, the debt service payments for the loop completion and the bottleneck were already figured into the water fund as well as in terms of the expense side. So those funds will have balances that are close. The only fund balance that will be just under what we should have is the sewer fund, and it's only by about, you know, $40,000 or so. So all of the other funds will be in the comfortable range in terms of reserves. So I think that's just about it. The last two pages are just extra pages should we need them. We don't have any information to be included, so I just left them blank. But there are no capital improvements with this. We were just going to include that in discussion for the normal budget talk.
What we're really here to talk about, what we're really here to do is approve the legislation that allows Melissa to submit this tax budget to the county auditor. And we have a motion to that effect.
I move.
Ready to take a vote?
Second.
Sure.
Well, we already had the motion.
Oh, we did have the motion.
Yeah. I guess, let me ask, are there any comments or questions from citizens? Okay.
I have a quick question.
Okay.
And it's about this recommended minimum reserve. It seems like I had always heard 25%, and then for a while we had about 50% when we were really flush in the days of getting estate taxes, basically. Mm-hmm. But then it seemed like recently, and I thought it was under you, but it might have been our previous finance director saying that other bodies were saying 5 to 10%, yeah, which seems really low. Am I crazy?
No. The Ohio Municipal League says 5%.
Yeah, okay. And I was looking, I thought that seemed a little strange, so mm-hmm. I started doing some more research, and I was looking at like the Government Financial Officers Association, the GFOA,
yeah,
and their recommended guidelines are 3 months, so that
okay.
would be 25%.
That's
but
what we had
talking
been.
To Patty, I feel more comfortable, because these are very loose projections. I mean,
mm-hmm.
I'm going off of what we've spent in 5 months, hoping that, you know, that trend continues in the second half of the year isn't heavily loaded with expenditures. So it makes me feel a little bit more comfortable if we have a little bit more of a buffer, just
mm-hmm.
because.
Yeah.
And also with, you know, the levy and everything else, it makes me feel better to have the general fund padded a little bit as well.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. That's helpful. I just wanted to make sure I wasn't misremembering.
No,
but wait,
I
yeah.
stated that because I found that, and after doing a little more research, I found that there are all kinds of different theories on that. So.
Okay. Great.
Right. And also just one other thing before Melissa sits down. Just to give you a heads up, I was hoping that in the near future we could hear a little bit more about income tax and just some of the options, because I know some different arguments have been raised mm-hmm. for that.
That's part of the tax discussion.
Yeah.
That's part of the discussion we're going to have leading up to the levy.
Yeah.
Well, I understand that, but I just want Melissa to be prepared,
yeah.
so
yeah.
I think that would be helpful.
Melissa and I have talked about a couple of different approaches, and she's going to work up some general revenue figures for the different things we talked about, like you know, having the forgiveness, raising the income tax, doing both. I mean, she
okay,
was going to work on some of those projections so that we could have those when we had the discussion.
Thank you.
And I would just like to say Melissa has done an incredible job. She
yes.
has worked so hard on this, and she has kept everybody in line. She's tightened up a lot of procedures as far as purchases and putting in requisitions, and she's just done an incredible job.
Thanks, Melissa.
Thanks, Melissa.
Melissa, we thank
Good
you
job.
So much.
Just
and
a reminder, the other half of this, once we file this with the county, we will get back another document which council has to approve accepting the rates. So there will be another agenda item in the next month or so that will allow council to accept the rates as a result of us putting this in with the county.
Okay, sounds great. Thank you.
Yeah, and again, thanks to all the workers. Make sure that
I will.
It gets conveyed that I think yeah. I can speak for the whole council that we're really pleased that they've taken so to heart the need to conserve, and so I just feel like a load is off my shoulders, so
yeah.
and that's really on them. They've done a great job.
Yes, they have. Yes, they have.
Okay, let's take a vote. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Okay. Now is the time in the agenda where we hear from citizens on items that are not on the agenda. You have 3 minutes. We ask that you come up to the podium and state your name. Come on up.
Hello. How are you tonight? My name is Cheryl Durgins. I am a resident of Yellow Springs, born and raised, went away for a while, came back. Question about a unit where I live off of Glenview Road. There's a subdivision or a new division that's been up over the past couple of years and has cropped up in the cornfield. It's like
Birch 3,
yeah,
I think
Birch
we call 3. It.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Question that I have has to do with runoff.
Mm.
We have experienced on our end more runoff as a result of not having that corn field
mm-hmm.
there. And so I'm wondering, has the village done any kind of study in that area about that? Because when it storms and it rains, it's really a lot more intense than it was ever. Mm-hmm. And that's the first question, mm-hmm. since I have 3 minutes. The other thing is I want to relay a message. July 4th, beautiful day. I was at the fireworks, beautiful. I actually went to high school with a former police officer's son, Officer Livingston, who is deceased, Huey Livingston. While we were at the end of the fireworks, we noticed that there was a police officer that was riding a bike, and just stone face, no comments, no hello, no greetings from the village, yada, yada, yada. And Eric Livingston, and I am going to say his name, the officer's son, turned to me and said, "Wow, the Yellow Springs police officers are really scary now." And I'm relaying that message because I know there's been a lot of discussions about community policing, and I have not been as involved as I will be. But I am relaying that message to City Council because I've heard a lot of praise this evening about the police officers, but I'm not convinced, as someone who has grown up, that this is being addressed appropriately. And those are my comments, and I thank you for the time, and that's all I have.
Thank you, Cheryl. Yes. Welcome to council meeting.
Yeah, thank you for coming.
Regarding the runoff, that's just something, what we typically do is assign, pass things along to staff. I would assign that to staff. Typically, when developments are installed or are built, they're required. They're not allowed to put more water onto the adjacent properties than previously. So I don't know, you know, we can have, you know, somebody look at it. We'll just pass it along to staff.
That sounds good.
Yeah, John will check into it. He is our planning and zoning person, and so he will check into that and get back with you. If you could maybe after the meeting make sure that we have your contact information.
Sure.
Thank you.
And we can...
Yeah, I was going to say, regarding the comments about the police department, it's great that we have the chief here, and he's a very open individual, willing, open-door policy. But you also might know that at our next meeting on July 20th, we're going to be having a working session. We're going to be focusing on that, so please be sure to come.
Yeah, the agenda for that is included, isn't it?
In yes. Our,
right, we're going to be discussing it.
The draft agenda is... When are we going to be discussing it?
Oh, in 2 minutes.
In like 2 minutes, we're coming. Yeah. So don't leave because that is going to be part of what we're talking about.
Awesome.
Okay.
The planning for that. We're not going to be discussing the issue, just planning how to talk about it, which is what we do a lot of here.
Any other?
We're not going to talk about it. We're going to talk about how to talk about it.
Any other citizen comments? Okay, I'll bring it back to council table. Next item under old business, since we removed the Environmental Commission discussion, is the biannual goals review. What I did was went through the document that we finalized and did some color coding, and I think it's pretty self-explanatory. It's a little hard to read. These colors are much darker than
They're better on the screen.
Yeah, I know. I don't know how highlight green and blue became
dark green.
Dark.
And dark blue.
Yeah. So, I don't counsel. I don't know if we. I honestly feel like we're doing quite well on our goals. Mm-hmm. You can see that there is really only one item that hasn't been addressed at all. I think it probably has been addressed, at least in discussion. We do acknowledge issues with the Green Space Fund. We just haven't discussed a specific strategy. But otherwise...
In regard to that, the Environmental Commission is meeting with Krista.
Okay,
and
that's great.
And Michelle at our meeting this month to talk about
that. So that can be a blue goal now.
Yeah.
Excellent.
That can be blue. So every one of these is either absolutely underway or is at least...
It's now blue.
Okay.
It goes from zero to blue.
Right. It is either underway or it has been identified and or will be in discussion. The plan for tax levy for 2016, that's on our agenda to discuss. We've added economic sustainability to the agenda. So I feel very positive about where we are. Council, any comments? Or
my only comment is that, you know,
I do feel that we need to prioritize the economic development discussion, and I'm excited now that John's got his legs, that that we'll be doing that in the next in a couple months.
Sounds good. Okay. Let's move along to the discussion of the police forum, or the, I guess, I don't even know, it's not really a forum. So it's
work
going
session.
To be at our work session, our July 20th work session will be, the major discussion will be about village policing and the police department. We have a draft agenda here that's been prepared by Brian and Mary Ann, and I'd like them to describe how they see the meeting kind of coming together.
Okay. So what we'd like to do is talk about our process a little bit, talk about this agenda, and open it up to council and community. So Brian and I met with a number of people that are listed here, including the chief and Patty and the former chief, some HRC members, and Ellis Jacobs specifically, to think about how do we want to frame this discussion. We also looked at materials from the forum that the Human Relations Commission had, materials that the police department had submitted in the past, and the articles that have appeared in the Yellow Springs News, and also included in the packet is something from HRC that identified the five issues that HRC felt were the main things that came out of the forum on policing, and they're listed in order of
priority. And this was in response to our request for a one pager.
Mm-hmm. So I'm seeing the goal of this as having a discussion happen at the council level. We've had concerns expressed by the community for, well, frankly, there's always going to be tension, I think, between the police department and citizens, just by the nature. Police have the force to, they can make people do things. So there's always going to be a certain amount of tension. But I'd say over the last couple years anyway, there has been more, seems like there has been more discussion and concern in the community. And the council itself, council has not really talked specifically or in general about issues regarding police, I don't think. So this is an opportunity for a discussion to happen at the council level, having listened to citizens, talked to police officers, whatever. And so this agenda has five parts. And our suggestion is for the first part, and I'm assuming this is going to take an hour and a half, something about that amount of time.
An hour and a half for
yes,
the entire, okay.
For this initial discussion, that each council member would have some time, up to 5 minutes, to just reflect on our own individual sense of whatever it is we want to reflect on, our experience with the police, what we've heard from citizens, whatever our thinking is. And then the second thing to discuss is what do we see as the values that we believe need to be expressed through the police department. The third section is concerns that have been listed. The national concerns were concerns that, well, Brian and I guess feel are impacting, at least in perception, local policing. And the local issues are things that have been actually identified and they have been identified, for example, in the HRC forum. The fourth section, strategies, might best be left, I mean, if we're going to have a discussion, it might be that we have the fourth section be something which we could leave for another discussion and maybe an interactive discussion with the chief, who can talk about some of these things that are actually have been tried. Some of them are being done. And there was one thing that I forgot to put on this list, which
under
was
number four. The list under number four?
On mm-hmm. potential strategies. And that is what is listed in the HRC document as number five. Well, actually, it could be four or five. That various people have said it would be good for some place for citizens to be able to come who feel they have concerns about the police department. They may not be comfortable going directly, or maybe they have gone directly to the chief, or they may have gone to the village manager. So that would be like a venue for community to voice concerns. And that, I would just ask that you put that under strategies, and I'll add that to the next document, but I just neglected to put that in. And then this is the beginning of a, well, it's not the beginning of a process, I think the HRC forms, but I don't imagine that the discussion will necessarily end at this next meeting, and so five is next steps, and I don't know what those next steps would be. So, Brian, do you have anything?
Yeah, I think that I really like, and Marianne did, the introduction paragraph and highlighting the fact that the goal, I think, of the work session on the 20th is to think about what we're striving for, with an emphasis on many of these things may already be happening, are already happening. And so, you know, just getting some clarification and agreement about what we're looking for there. The other thing that I guess I want to emphasize is that the bullet points here are really more to sort of engage ideas. Not that we're going to drill down on each of these in this initial discussion, because really I think our goal from since last October was to formally talk about this at council table and decide what are the values that we're striving for, what are the behaviors, and then look at what's working and what we could tweak. I know that Chief Hale has said that he will help us with, I believe it's section two, by providing us with a revision of sort of the mission and objectives of what the YSPD is focusing on now to help frame the discussion. And I think those were kind of the main things I wanted to emphasize. But I guess the one concern I have is that it's very easy to start to drill down on some of these specifics, but I think our stated goal has been really to think more about the higher level. What are those values, principles, beliefs that we're striving for? And then we can start looking at some of the priority issues. Clearly, the ACE task force is going to be one of those when we start talking about budget. But the goal is not to drill down on that issue on the 20th. Same with some of the other things that may come up in the future.
Mm-hmm. Quick question procedurally. Do citizens have access to this document that we've been talking about? Mm-hmm. They've got it?
It's in the packet.
But I mean, was it out on the table?
Yeah.
So, okay, just making sure. Because
yeah.
Otherwise it'd be very confusing. And also, I wonder if we could start projecting, because I thought part of our idea in redoing this was to be able to put more of our documents up on a screen.
We need a TV.
We still need a TV to do that. I think it would.
With that big budget we've got, maybe we can find some money.
Like with our budget discussion and thing, just putting it will be a lot easier if we can try to make it a priority to get a screen up there so people are very clear about what document we're talking about. That's just
that.
A little procedural
thing.
But otherwise, I think this looks pretty good. I think it'll be a good starting point.
I'm not sure that, you know, I'm still not, you know, this issue of issues regarding the Yellow Springs Police Department, I'm not comfortable with that wording to begin with. You know, and I don't know, I'm still gathering information. You know, I hear a lot of accusations, I hear a lot
Karen,
of comments.
Karen, where are you?
The first one, number one. Each council member will have up to 5 minutes to give their own perspective on issues regarding the YSPD.
Right.
I mean, I'm wondering why we're starting with council with that. It seems to me that we should just be starting with a discussion of the issues, a summary of the issues.
Was that an attempt to kind of clarify?
I, as I was thinking about it, I thought that might be a way to start, because each of us probably has our own perspective. Each of us has had interactions with different community members, as well as with the department, and I thought it would just be a way to sort of put out
I think it's that word issues. It's often a euphemism for problems. And so
well, maybe just cross out issues.
Just perspective. Perspective on the
Yellow Springs Police Department.
And police, Yellow Springs policing. Maybe.
That might make more sense. Perspective on Yellow Springs policing.
Mm. Yeah, when Marianne and I discussed this, I mean, it was definitely, the idea was to give everybody a chance just to talk about what they've heard, what they're thinking. So.
I guess that makes me, you know, I don't know. I don't like to be, you know, it's like I'm calling one person, calling the integrity of one group or one person or another into question before I feel like we've really fleshed out this discussion. And comments we've heard from citizens, I guess I don't feel ready to verbalize that yet. I feel like we're still in the discussion. We're still in an exploratory phase of this. And I'm still learning what the concerns are. And I hear the concerns. I also hear our police chief suggesting that some of those concerns aren't actual. So I guess I feel like starting with that is council giving voice to one issue or another, or to, so I.
You would be more comfortable starting with number two.
I thought we were just going to do a round, you know, kind of have a round table, have a general discussion about the issues that citizens are expressing and that have already been heard.
I will speak only for myself that I have certain, I mean, I've been thinking about this before I ran for council, and of course all the time I've been on council, and I just have certain perspectives and thinking that I would like to share. It's not so much about this citizen said this or this citizen said that. For me, it's more how does Yellow Springs and what is happening with policing in our village, how does that fit into the national scene? That's a lot of what I have been thinking about. But anyway, so I wanted to just have a chance to speak about that. And I've lived here for a long time, so I have a sense of how things have changed or not changed.
But wouldn't you be able to do that in number three?
I'm speaking for myself.
No, I'd like to do this,
but if everyone wants to change the agenda, that's fine.
I mean, I think, I feel like it's a semantic distinction. That
perhaps
you're imagining that you might come with some prepared comments, right?
Yeah.
And Karen, I think, is saying, I'm not at a point where I have a position or want that where I feel like I'm even ready to take any kind of position, and that might be what you want to communicate at that point, is that you're still more in listening mode and in, and so for me, whatever we call it, a discussion, or if we call it having 5 minutes to give your perspective, to me it kind of winds up being the same thing. So I'm comfortable with it, but you know, people can have the chance to say, I'm still listening right now, and I am not in a place where I want to say anything.
I guess for me, you know, I would probably say nothing for number one, and jump into discussion later. If number one said my own perspective about policing, and not specifically talking about the Yellow Springs Police Department, I would be comfortable with that.
Let's say that.
Yeah.
I mean, that's fun.
Yeah, because when I thought about this and we discussed it, it was more of a how we've opened many discussions is just an opportunity to, you know, raise our thoughts, and then we have the citizens engage at that point.
Are you comfortable with that if we just talk about our perspectives on policing?
Right. I mean, I think that makes a little bit more sense to me. Chief, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I would be happy and as transparent as possible with whatever you would like. Me, what I sort of envisioned is back in October, November, we had a community ordering policing. There were several questions that got answered. I still have those questions. I would very much love to address those questions. Mm-hmm. I would like to show you what we have done in the 9 months I've been here, mm-hmm. what policies exist on how we're addressing some of those, what progress we've made, or maybe that request just isn't realistic, and a chance to go over what was discussed and show you where we're going, and then if there's further direction or you decide you want more progress in a certain area, I'd be happy to discuss that. And that's sort of where I would like that opportunity to do that. So if you want to keep that in mind.
Mm-hmm. How long, what amount of time do you think would be 15 minutes?
Think 30 or so we could go over. There's a lot of questions. A lot of them are sort of generic questions. 3 or 4 questions are often answered by one answer. I probably issued 20 plus policies on everything from internal investigations, use of force. All those things are written down. They're all public information available. I'll try not to bore you with all the detail over it, but give you synopsis of those and how they pertain then to the original questions. So that was, I would love that opportunity in this discussion.
Were you too aware of this, and how did you see that working into this agenda?
So we're having a conversation right now because it's not, I haven't been clear what is the best way to do this, but I was imagining that the next meeting that we do this would be more what you're talking about, of that this would be an opportunity basically for council to talk, and some of the things that we would say might be questions to have you address, and then the next time we have a work session, or possibly combine it in this work session, have a time for you to talk about both what you're talking about as well as, you know, some of these bullet points on potential strategies are things that you are doing.
May I make a suggestion? Yes. Perhaps Chief could do the preparatory work of preparing the synopsis and answering to the questions, and having it in your package for the next meeting, not necessarily to discuss at that meeting, but for you to have to read and be prepared. And perhaps then if your question is answered, you can move on to another question that isn't being answered. That way we can get more information.
To me, this is at the heart of the discussion. I mean, why are we going to spend time talking about policies and issues that Chief is addressing? You know, I don't want to spend another meeting, you know, talking about what the Yellow Springs Police Department isn't doing before we have our chief lay out what he is doing and what how the police department is operating.
How I see the process having moved so far is we had a forum, when was that, in October?
October 23rd.
So October 2014, last October, and lots of issues were raised, pages and pages of issues. And police, Chief Hale was there or got all the lists? Because it was after, right, it was.
Yeah, he was there.
So he got all of that information and he has been trying to respond to it and put policies in place that will help hopefully deal with some of those issues. We had a semi-formal presentation of some of those findings to council, but haven't had a full discussion of them, partly because we were in the process of hiring a new chief at that time. We had the forum, we had lots of information came in. The police force has had some time, about 7 months, 8 months to respond to that information. So giving them a chance to say, here is how we've tried to respond to this. This is what we've got in place. This is what we're working on. Here's where we are in terms of what came in at that time. Then having a more a response to that, to me, there is a logic in that. But obviously, I don't want to step on what you've done, but I can see the logic in that.
I mean, when you said this is a council discussion, so were you not seeing citizens being involved?
I was seeing citizens being involved.
So I guess
primarily a chance for. I may be wrong, but I'm not aware that council has ever really talked about the police department policing at a council meeting. And citizens have talked about it a lot. So I'm not saying that there wouldn't be a chance for citizens to talk, but I felt like it was appropriate for council to address, to speak to the public and have.
But I also think it's appropriate for council to really understand the policies that are being criticized and that citizens are upset about and have the police department respond. And I don't have a full understanding of the policies. I don't have a full understanding of, the concerns, the over-aggression, the stops for no cause. I mean, I'd like to see some statistics or have some discussion or learn from the police department. We're hearing from citizens that this is all happening. I'd like to see either statistics or comments or hear from the police department what their response is to the accusations and get a better understanding of what our policy is. I mean, I feel like that all of these accusations are being thrown around and they just keep getting thrown around and we really haven't gotten to the heart of it from the police department. And if we spend another meeting where it's going to be more citizens talking about things that the Yellow Springs Police Department has been doing incorrectly or not to their liking, and another meeting not hearing from the police department with any sort of response or any sort of understanding of what their policies really are, I feel like we just keep running in circles.
So, Karen, are you saying that rather than this agenda, you would prefer to have Chief Hale come and talk to us about changes?
I feel like it needs to be part. I feel like us understanding what policies and procedures are going on in the police department is important.
In the follow-up on that, at least for me, I did not attend any of the forums, okay? The chief did. So he received all the questions, if I'm correct.
Yes.
Okay. So I would like to then hear his response, okay? Then I think I would be better able to then join in a discussion my perspectives on what I think policing should be, and I think we all could. That way, the chief would know, or at least have a good idea, am I going in the right direction? You follow me? And I agree with Mary Ann saying that council needs to have a discussion on it. But I think that discussion should be around what the chief has prepared and what he's done in the last, you know, since he's been hired, the last 7 or so months. And then we'd have a dialogue back and forth on, you know, again, is he going in the right direction? Yes, there may still be community concerns, okay? But, you know, are those concerns isolated incidents, or are they concerns, you know, as a whole? You know, so, you know, it's somewhat of a fine line. And I, being an African American, I look at some of this stuff, and no one has approached me, okay? So, again, I know what has happened in the past, but I don't know what has happened since Chief Hill has taken the reins and so forth. And I see him out every day walking and so forth. So, you know, that would help me frame, you know, my discussions and so forth. But, you know, without having that, I think we're just going to go around in circles again. And, you know, and I think it should, you know, it should start with, I went to the forum, this is what they told me, this is what I've done, now let's talk about it.
So. Well, I do want to mention just two things. You know, first of all, specifically what we talked about 2 months ago and sort of how this first discussion would go, which was, do we need to kind of identify what the values are that then drive that policy? And I remember that was something that Mary Ann suggested, sort of like, you know, going up to that higher level. And the second thing I do remember after October is that we said several times that we never sort of formalized those values here at council table. It was a forum. We got the information. I mean, honestly, for me, the values are there. We've got them. And so we don't need to have that discussion. That's okay with me. But I do think this plan was designed around what we talked about 2 months ago, that we were going to have that higher level discussion to then think about what drives policy. And I think that's why when Mary Ann said that was sort of the next discussion. Mm-hmm. But I mean, for me, I'm flexible about what we need to do. But I agree with Mary Ann. I don't think we ever had that sort of recognition of what came out of the October 23rd forum.
Well, could I ask Chief?
Sure.
Could I? So we did have the forum in which you were the presenter. I mean, we had the initial forum in October.
Oh, right. Yeah, okay.
And then we had the conversation
in
March.
Then we had the second forum, which you, in the gym.
Yes.
So I guess I have two questions.
You mean when we were doing the hiring process?
No, we had the community conversation.
We had two HRC forums.
That one?
Yeah, it was in March.
Not as many people came to that forum,
okay,
but
I
the whole forum
was
Chief Hale basically talking. There was some chance for people to ask you questions, but
that was truly a question and answer session with
right.
citizens.
Yeah.
I took about 5 minutes, explained who I was, took questions. 1 hour and a half, 1 hour and 40 minutes.
So if you've been clearly listening to this discussion, would you be prepared to come to the next council meeting on the 20th with, I guess you have a list of questions and things that you want to present to council and the community about what you've been doing and answering questions that were asked?
The list that Mr. Hausch compiled from the October forum, again, there's several of those. A lot of the questions are very, very similar. A lot of the questions, their concerns are similar. A lot of those I can put up on a PowerPoint, go through policy, how this is addressed. Well, you know, if a person has an officer complaint, how do you handle that? It's all spelled out. You know, that's fairly easy to do, and that would take 15 to 20 months. I just think that sort of gives closure back to the whole forum from October, because I don't know that we ever really have gotten there. And I think, you know, you address that, you close the issues, let me say where we want to go, what else is coming, what else I'd like to do, and a little bit of my vision on how we get the police department to where the village and you as council want it to be.
So you would present essentially a, here's what we heard in October, here's our progress towards these goals, and here are the plans for the future kind of thing.
I would very much like the opportunity. To me, that's that closure for the October forum, and that would allow me to do that. It's easy for me to sit and say, well, I want to do this.
Right.
You know, I've been permanent chief now for 6 full months. Here's what I've done. Here's what is written. Here's how things have been handled. Mm-hmm. So.
I think part of the concern I sense might be that I might be getting from Mary Ann is there's a probably also a fear that we will become this kind of defensive body where, and that's what I think Mary Ann is kind of trying to avoid, that we're not approaching citizens who have concerns as we're closing ranks here and we're going to just defend village government actions regardless. Am I correct in understanding that you wanted it to be more open? Is that part of it?
Not exactly. I mean, we've been hearing from citizens for, I'm still thinking about what Chief
Hale said.
Okay,
I'm sorry.
Did.
Yeah, I'm kind of
throwing
the two balls.
I was going to suggest maybe Brian and I could get together with the chief and Patty or something and redraft an agenda that would include what Chief Hale is suggesting.
For me, I feel like it would be more grounding, and I would try to be very conscious that I still want to be able to be open and make it clear that, and I think Chief is usually pretty good about this, that he's putting it out there to say, this is what I'm doing. Now you have every right to come in and say, well, I think that policy or that change is a problem because it's causing this. That would be the purpose, would not just be for us to present this is what the government is doing right or wrong, but to say, here's what we're doing. Citizens come and tell us, what do you see? What are you hearing? What do you like? What do you have concerns about the where we're going? So that I think would help give us some grounding. So I would love it if you'd do that, but I also want to say I always feel bad when a committee goes out, does some hard work, does some hard thinking, and then it kind of gets shut down. So I hope you're not feeling bad about it, because I think you did. You gave us something to work with.
I don't think we're talking about changing it that much. I mean, I think it's, I really don't. I mean, I would say substituting, this is the first discussion. I mean, this is not going to happen. This is not going to stop with this discussion.
Right.
I think that the fact that we're sitting here talking about it, we've been talking about it, we've asked HRC to do this work, to do the forums, it's clear that this council values a positive community and police interaction, and we want to do something about it. So I don't know. I don't know that now is the time for, you know, I want to hear from the chief. I want to hear what he's done. I want to understand why the police department is doing certain things. You know, I know all of these things are the complaints. I want to understand the rationale from the police, from the standpoint of the police department, as to if these things are happening with frequency in the Yellow Springs Police Department, why, or infrequency. So I would like to hear from the PD. I think the values discussion is important. Maybe this is still just an information gathering discussion.
Definitely.
I mean, this to me is seeming more, you know, more end focused than beginning focused, I think.
So I think in a practical way, would you suggest basically changing the first one to presentation instead of 25 minutes of council 30 minutes to Chief Hale.
Yeah.
At that point, and then move through the rest of the agenda.
Mm-hmm. I mean, that, I think that makes sense personally. It just, in this stage of the discussion.
Okay. Well, maybe, should we open it to community, or do you have, so we can ponder that for a while, or do you want to respond right away?
Well, if we're seeing this as part of a process,
mm-hmm.
I mean, maybe I'll just write a letter. I can, on my own, state what I think, and I might write a letter, put in the packet, or write a letter to mm-hmm. the paper, but...
Well, I think we could definitely have a place where council people can offer our perspectives, and whether that is that right at the beginning or at some other point. And plus, I would think, you know, if you want to kind of MC the thing, I know it's mm-hmm. normally the president.
No, I mean, I'm
if
fine.
You wanted to kind this of MC this part of the discussion,
I would want to get together with the chief though, mm-hmm. before the meeting to talk about
sure.
this more.
Sure. But I think if you want to put in a place where we can all talk about our perspectives on policing,
well, and
or however you want to do it, I think it would probably be fine.
And perhaps the proper place for that would be at the end of number three, because you've discussed what has happened up to this point, you've discussed the issues, and before you discuss the potential strategies to meet them, maybe at that point council can say, okay, this is what I've seen and heard. Let's talk about the strategies.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that's a good place.
But I don't know, but I would like to be able to get together so we
sure.
can okay. come to an agreement.
And I think whatever you all decide, I think, I mean, so we'll
requesting that.
Sure, absolutely.
We'll be fine with it.
Okay.
Well, and I just want to reiterate, you know, I think the vision has been a higher level discussion.
Right.
So, mm-hmm. you know, when these points were listed, Mary Ann pulled out, you know, just the things that have been focused on just to remind mm-hmm. us. But I don't anticipate that it's, you know, going deep on any of them. So
well, then I guess that's the confusion, though. Then,
right.
if it is, if you guys are envisioning it as a high-level discussion, we're getting down into detail in this agenda, and so maybe that's the confusion on my part.
No, and it's easy to be confused because honestly, every meeting, from my perspective, that we had with some of the different stakeholders, it did get into the details, and so I think it's hard to separate the two. You almost have to look at the examples to think about what are the values mm-hmm. and what are the principles.
Well, I think it's difficult to figure out how to have this discussion.
It is.
That we're doing this right now. And
yeah.
you know, see, it's not easy.
Yeah.
I mean, it doesn't happen that often right. either, I think.
But, no. What you've done a great job
yeah,
of
yeah.
here is really distilling out I mean, it was pages and pages, and anybody who's looked at the results of that forum, that was tons of information, and I'm really impressed with how you've distilled it down here. I would like to hear if there's any thoughts from citizens
sure.
out there
yeah.
on this.
Yeah, sure.
Can you come up, Cheryl?
So, because I missed the other two, I mean, I
mm-hmm.
can't. Appreciate that there is a discussion, but I did have a question about the high. You're saying higher level discussion, and I'm not understanding. I think what that means in terms of how that is a response to the discussions you've had before. So, are you saying that you're trying to, as a council,
yeah? What's the policy for
yeah.
the village?
Okay.
Is I think
because okay.
these forums never happen at a council meeting,
okay.
and so you know I think it's that sort of recognition of what does the village want
mm-hmm.
in its policing policy.
And so you're saying that you need more information before you can kind of comment on it, and your understanding is you have some opinions about where you'd like things to go. And in the course of that, it would be nice to know, as a as someone who will attend the meeting, just kind of the range of where people are. So I do think it's very important for council to at least comment. Mm-hmm. That's just my opinion.
Right. Well, we will be commenting through the entire meeting.
Okay.
It's mm-hmm. Are we making a big statement to start a meeting about how we feel about policing in Yellow Springs before we've had the discussion?
Okay. All right. I'm clear now.
Yeah. Great. Thanks. No, it's helpful because this is hard. It's sort of trying to bring in a lot of stuff that's happened outside council. How do you bring that into mm-hmm. council?
Yeah.
I think it would be really helpful to make sure, and I haven't looked at the website recently enough, but to make sure that in our packet that citizens can have access to for people who weren't at those forums. Because I think we got a written report, right, from
HRC.
And
we've got the videos.
So we want to make sure that all of that is, so if anybody who wants to review any of that, see what was already discussed so they don't feel like they have to reinvent that wheel.
I'm sorry. Can I ask just real quick?
Yeah.
So that's going to be listed on the website?
Okay, so usually we get an electronic packet. Everything that's out there on paper,
yes,
we get electronically and we put it up on the website so
gotcha.
People can prepare for our meetings at the
okay.
same time we're preparing for them. It goes up Friday afternoon before the the meeting on Monday. So you
right.
have the weekend to sort of look things over.
Right.
So what I'm saying is in our packet, and that's available to citizens in the newspaper, and we put a copy in the library, that what's available is the background material that might be helpful.
Awesome. Okay, thank you.
So you were the one that was wanting to get out of the meeting at 9:30?
I know. I'm off.
Okay. So I think what we are ending this discussion by saying that...
I think we have another citizen.
Oh, okay.
Sorry, Garrett. I know you're trying to move along. I did want to ask a question, and maybe this is too obvious, but I was prompted in a way by the configuration here of the conversation. We've got several of the parties who are involved, the chief, the council, the manager, each having distinct roles in establishing what the village role in law enforcement and policing would be. I wonder how, I mean, I'm going to presume that HRC knows this, that some citizens are well informed about it, but perhaps some others aren't. I mean, Chief Hale's suggestion about discussing his own policy work since coming here makes a certain amount of sense. And, you know, also the sort of different inputs, the different processes to that. But then there's also the sort of philosophy of what council sees its role. Not necessarily, you know, what your policy is or what your sort of praise or gripe with police forces, but how you see the work of council informing policing in the village. Or similarly, Patty's role, you know, as a manager. What sort of roles and processes do you want to try to bring forward? But that's useful context as well. And I think it's not as well, my hunch is it's not that well understood by the general population, unless they've taken a look at the charter or spent some time
mm-hmm.
Trying to understand the way that these meetings and practices actually work out.
Right. That might be something
Thanks, Jen.
Good for the
Thank
introductory
you.
Materials would be.
Yeah.
Somebody to sort of say, here's what council's role is, here's what the village manager's role is, here's what the police chief's role is, so people do have a better understanding of that. Good point.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Dan. So Mary Ann, Brian, Chief, and Patty will be working together to finalize the agenda for the July 20th work session. It will be a work session only since we decided that we weren't going to, and hopefully we won't have any additional legislation that we have to deal with. Okay, next is the draft board and commission ordinance. Brian and Mary Ann again.
Yeah, so maybe I'll lead this discussion. You know, it's gone through several iterations. I rewatched the meeting to capture all the comments that were made after the last round. And I think we're getting pretty close. We had about 6 comments. Maybe the best thing for me to do is just go through and highlight where changes were done and are made. And the context, of course, is that this was put into a sample ordinance with the Environmental Commission, just as a starting point. So Everything that's in the current environmental commission that's sort of specific to that commission was brought into this general format, and if we like it, we can do it with the others. The first section, 274.01, there's nothing there beyond just adding the purpose that's already in the current ordinance. When we get to 0.02, if you look at B, what was added was charged with directing, this is the second line, and supervising commission activities. This was the comment that one council person made about the need to clarify the role of the council liaison. So we've got that in there. If you look at C, the last part, non-resident members should only be appointed in exceptional circumstances. We talked several times about emphasizing that these were special cases, so I added that. If you go to F, we had the comment that maybe there would be situations where the limitation on two terms, we would not always want that, so added generally. And then also the second sentence, however, council may determine in certain situations it would be appropriate. In G, I added the last sentence about the alternates, and this was related to the idea of what's the track of an alternate, so that it's clear that if an alternate is going to become a permanent or regular member, that that still goes through the process of coming to council, nominating that person and approving them, which is actually going to happen tonight. And then that's it. So otherwise, this is the document that we looked at 2 months ago with those changes, and then putting it in the context of the Environmental Commission.
Mm-hmm. And how do you see, you'll basically go it to all of the others and do some similar?
Yeah. So if we're good with this model, then I'm willing to do it for each commission. And then I would just hope that, you know, the council liaisons for those commissions would look carefully just to make sure that nothing's missing.
Okay.
So this is the example from the Environmental Commission.
Right.
Did you get the one on the table?
Because it was it wasn't in the packet.
Yeah, it was in our packet when we, you know, moved it forward.
Right.
Yeah. So anyway, but yeah, those were, and then I think there were two questions that came up that maybe we do need to discuss. Going back to 0.02C, a question was raised about qualified in the first line and who determines that. I mean, my thought would be that, you know, that's what council does. That's part of our nominating process. But maybe there's some language to add there.
Maybe qualified, interested. Well, I guess candidates makes it. Never mind. I don't think we need the word interested.
Well, and it also says or other compelling reason.
Yeah.
Do we have qualifications established anywhere?
Well, it does.
Just what we, you know, we sort of have a, what is it, under
A.
Right. Is it under
no.
A?
No, wait a minute.
We do have something that just talks about education and is it D?
D, yeah.
Yeah. Experience, expertise, education.
So at least we have something that establishes qualifications.
Right.
So it's.
And then Patty also raised an issue that.
The only question that I had was if you look at I'm trying to find it here, the last bullet point I, the commission or board will have available to it through the village manager's office without cost to its members those things necessary to carry out as charged, such as meeting room, copying, printing, postage. Any other expenditure funds must be approved by council. And don't have a problem with that, but it's difficult to track what committees and commissions are doing what, because it's all coming out of my budget, like using my code on the copier, and, you know, that kind of thing. It also, I mean, we recently had an issue, just Brian and I were discussing earlier tonight, with one of the commissions and how we're going to pay for something that's not in the budget. Then additionally to that, you have HRC, who has its own budget. And my suggestion would be, if it's all going to come out of my budget, then we need to find a way to make sure that everybody's doing the same thing. Like, we can track that HRC is making X number of copies because they have their own code on the copier, and just so that we know who's spending what.
Right.
Because it's really difficult to plan a budget when I don't know who's spending what, essentially.
Does it make sense for it to come out of your budget when it's a village commission?
Come out of council.
Shouldn't it come
budget.
Out of council budget?
Well, this is a carryover.
Yeah, it's
right. It's what was already,
right.
It's currently.
And, but this language doesn't say what budget
right.
line it's coming
right.
out of.
It should come out of council's budget,
well,
because
it's
a council commission.
And planning and BZA do, because Judy makes all those copies and everything.
Right.
So. But, you know, at the last minute, if they come in and somebody doesn't have a copy of an agenda or something, they'll want to, like, run down and make a copy. And
right.
I mean, if it's just one or two here and there and there's no postage or whatever, that's one thing.
Well, but I wonder if they almost shouldn't be going through the clerk's office then. Obviously,
I thought that they were. I mean, I copy agendas and various things for Brian on a regular basis. So.
Well, and I thought so too until Brian said, yeah, but if we need something at the last minute, we were told to use this code, which is my code.
Right.
So,
well,
it's
personally,
just
I would
plan.
Say this should actually say through, since they are commissions of council,
yeah.
It should go through the clerk's office. So I'm really glad this came up. And it
yep.
should be on a council, financially, it should come out of the council line in the budget.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that makes sense. So change that to the clerk's office?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And so they have to be aware that the clerk has somewhat limited hours during the day, partly because we keep her here so much at night.
Well, it's part of this also is, you know, to get the commissions on a schedule, an agenda,
right.
a week ahead, so people know what's going on and that sort of thing. Yeah, I think it got a little bit loose and the mm-hmm. code got passed around or whatever.
Right, and
so.
Well, then are you going to change your code?
Well, I guess I'm going to have to change my code, yeah. But, you know, part of the problem is that we have these wonderful commissions and committees and boards that have these great ideas, but they're not necessarily funded, and then when we go to, suddenly somebody has spent something and we don't, you know, it's not encumbered, so.
And I'm not talking about HRC. I think that there needs to be some control. I mean, you know, are we just going to be printing thousands and thousands of pages? I mean, what?
Well, we haven't done that so far. I mean, it's been, at least from my experience, it's been agendas, you know,
okay. Maybe some handouts.
And yeah, I run all my stuff through Judy.
Mm-hmm.
So
right, and it just says to carry its charge, such as meeting room, copying and printing and postage.
Well, for instance, when the discussion about the CAP survey, one of the things was, are we going to put it in the newspaper? Are we going to mail out the surveys? Are
right.
we going to do Survey Monkey? There was discussions
need,
like that.
I think we need to start having a line item for commission expenses.
Mm-hmm.
We absolutely do, and I don't know what we do. This is something we'll discuss in budget time.
Right.
I don't know what we do about HRC, but I think we need to start tracking that, and we need to start giving each commission maybe a couple $100 or whatever sum we deem is reasonable, and
mm-hmm.
keep that as a separate line item. And I think that.
And then if they want to do anything special, they just got to come to council.
And
right.
I don't know. I think we're talking about procedures that don't need to be in a piece of legislation.
True.
I think it's something that does need to be controlled, and I would hope that the
mm-hmm.
commission liaison would work with staff
mm-hmm.
to deal with that and to get and for the commission members to understand that you don't automatically have a budget. You can't just spend money without getting approval from somebody.
Right. The only thing that needs to change here, I think, is that it should be clerk's office.
Right, but I don't think we need to get into the detail. You guys need.
But I think it was good that that came up. Because I also, you know, I didn't think about it until Patty raised it.
Yeah, I mean, it's just really difficult to track.
Absolutely.
It's just, you know, it's really difficult to track whether, you know, I'm here, John's here, we both use the same code on the copier, and if somebody.
Well, the other nice thing is you guys are actually, you're ex officio for any of the commissions. So if there is that emergency, you know, we can take, you can take care of that.
Okay. Can we move on? We're very late in the agenda.
Do we need to do anything more with this?
Are we approving it or just? But we need legislation, don't we need, I mean, are we going to have an ordinance? Maybe an ordinance that covers all the new commission ordinances?
We'll have to, I think we'll have to do a separate one for each.
Well,
Right.
I would like to have, maybe consider having it all at once.
Yeah, I think we're ready to move to that.
All at one meeting, but that's going to be one heck of a, it would be nice if there is a way, talk to our solicitor and see if there is a way. Yes, they're all individual pieces of legislation, but maybe we can pass them as one. Somehow, let's look into that.
At least read them the first time on the consent agenda.
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's make it streamlined as possible.
We can put our ordinance on the consent agenda.
Any other comments or changes? Because, yeah, I can definitely get with Chris on the, you know, the nitty gritty.
Yeah, I do have one question. If there's a meeting, given that we can have two alternates, if there is a meeting in which there are, let's say the commission has five members and two alternates, and two members come and two alternates come, so there are four people. Do the alternates at that point count as, okay.
Yes.
Yes.
And that's the whole reason why.
That's exactly what happened at HRC the last time.
Right.
Okay, got it.
Cool.
Although there is issues related to voting, but.
Right.
That's.
But that is outlined here.
Right, it's discussed, yes. Okay, so work that out, you know, see what we can do to make that legislation as streamlined as possible. Okay, August meeting schedule and agenda. So if we look forward to the future agenda items, we just added one, which is 1% pay increase for staff. That will be a resolution. So that's legislation. On our table that I haven't even had a chance to read is a pretty detailed memo from John Courtney, to which is attached a memo from AMP about our portfolio, and it looks like something we want to consider. So this is going to have to be added to our agenda.
Excuse me, that has to be at the next, you're going to have a meeting at the
okay.
next work session.
So that's.
Because that's due by the 31st of July, so you're going to have to vote on
and
it.
And you feel that it's significant enough for us?
I don't know that I really recommend it because of the minimal amount of it, but it's something that council has discussed in the past, and I think that you should be aware of it. It's a simple portfolio realignment. We potentially can sell the two pieces that are non-renewable.
Okay, great.
Okay.
So let's put
so
it
we'll,
on the agenda.
Okay, so July 20th, I think we're fleshing out. July 20th, so we've got the policing policy. We will have a special meeting. We will have to have a special meeting to discuss this AMP memo.
I would love to do the, if since we're going to have a little meeting and the pay resolution, I don't think there'll be a lot of discussion on it. I'd rather have it get done.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
Now rather than.
So add that to July 20th.
Got it.
Okay. Do we want to start the special meeting at 6 o'clock? So that will be when we discuss legislation. Or 6:30 maybe.
6:30 maybe. Do we think people are going to want to come to this? My hesitation is people are used to us starting at 7, and when we started at 6 the last time and had legislation they were concerned about, and they got confused and came at 7, and I think felt kind of cheated.
Okay, so we can start at 7, and these two discussion items will probably be, they will come first on the agenda, and we can probably dispatch of them pretty quickly.
I think so.
Maybe hopefully 15 minutes. Okay, we have canceled our August 3rd meeting, which means that our, at this point, the only meeting we have scheduled for August is the August 17th, is it August 17th?
I'm not looking.
And it would be a work session. Since the second meeting has been deemed to be a work session, it would be a work session. There are some potential pieces of legislation, the ordinances related to Antioch College. John, briefly, do you have any status on those?
The ordinance regarding the North College Street, we do have the description for that. We got that last week, and once we get the agreement, we can have that ready for council.
I'm just asking, will they be ready?
For August 17th.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Will they be ready for July 20th?
Possibly.
Those have been on our agenda for an awfully long time.
Those are going to be easy, I would say.
I would love to get those off of it. So let's put those tentatively at the July 20th special meeting.
Well, I think maybe it would be better to start a little early.
Okay, we can start early, but just let's be very clear in our communication about that, because people really did get confused.
Start the work session at 7:00.
Right, yeah. Start the meeting at 6:30. We have...
6:30 or 6:00, because if you add two...
We'll have four pieces of legislation.
There's another thing you could add there, which is, there was a question about approving or not approving a letter of support for a matter that Miami Township is going to bring for a short discussion, and that would require that you be able to agree to that.
6 o'clock, okay. And we will add that to the agenda, and we'll talk about that briefly. So I guess in some respects that might, so what we had tentatively planned for, well, we've got the economic sustainability discussion, which we've assigned to the August 17th work session. But then we have the budget presentation, levy timeline. I think there was some thought, should we add a meeting? Should we add a second meeting in August? Maybe we can wait till the next, till the...
I think, let's see how it's shaking up by...
July 20th.
By the July 20th, and we can decide whether we're going to need a second meeting.
Okay. Sounds good. Is everybody in agreement with that?
Right, and just one thing to factor in is John's travel.
Oh, yeah.
Right, I mean, just as far as what he, because there are some discussions...
You will be here for the 17th, right?
So my flights have been finalized. I'll be leaving on the 23rd of July. I'll arrive back in Dayton on Saturday, the 8th of August.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Well, you can just use that jet lag to stay awake and get more done.
Perfect timing for, I'm really glad we decided to have a gap in our meeting schedule.
Yeah, well, that'll work out great. You'll have for a week.
Both our clerk and our assistant, we have that little gap of no packing.
Okay, so next on the agenda is commission nominations. Brian, I believe you have several nominations?
Yes, okay, so let's start with a community access panel. Jerry, do you want to say anything about Jordan Gray?
No, go ahead.
Okay, so Jordan Gray has been involved in the SpringsNet piece, so he does come with a technical background. He also actually, and it's mentioned in his resume, worked in broadcasting through the web. So he's actually got some experience that's directly relevant to where the station may move. Very committed, really wants to serve, and so I would like to nominate him for the community access panel.
Second.
We didn't get...
Yeah, it's on the table.
Oh.
Yeah, and we did have it by email a while back, but...
Yeah, that's the second copy, isn't it?
Yeah.
So we have a nomination and a second. Is everybody ready to vote? Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And he also already signed his roles and responsibilities. So for the Public Art Commission, I mentioned at our last meeting, Jerry and Lori were not here, but Matthew Hausch and John Hudson, because of their schedules, need to move to alternate positions. So the first thing I want to do is nominate A.J. Warren, who we all know very well, and he's been an alternate for almost a year now. Obviously very committed and really wants to be a full member. So I'd like to nominate A.J. for the Public Art Commission.
Second. And I've been to most of the Public Art Commission meetings, and A.J. is phenomenal.
Yeah, it's nice to have a younger person, too.
Great.
Okay.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay. And the last one, also on the table, Jamie Sharp, brings a really important element to the Public Art Commission, which is the graphic design background. She actually attended our meeting last month and was already hitting the ground running. She's done some different things to help with some of the work the commission is doing, which is nice since we don't have a budget. So Karen and I have interacted with her in the meeting context.
She's a good person.
Yeah, she's awesome. So I'd like to also nominate Jamie Sharp for the Public Art Commission.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. Managers, and first the manager's report and then the assistant manager's report.
My report is in the packet. If anyone has any questions, I do have two small additional items. One was the information from John Courtney that you need to review for the next meeting. And the second one is a reminder to everyone that your vegetation cannot grow out across the sidewalk. It makes it difficult and sometimes impassable for people. And since I've been doing extra walking lately, I have noticed quite a few more instances of that.
Yes, and we have some vision impaired people who it's very difficult for them if there's vegetation that's coming across their face.
Right, we do. And so the Public Works crew does, in fact, send out letters about that. And they do also, in fact, at times cut that back if you don't tend to yourself. So I'm sure that folks would rather from their own vegetation back than have our Public Works crew do it.
Are there fines involved?
There could potentially be fines involved, yes.
Okay.
So if you could please pay a little bit of attention to that when your vegetation starts growing out across the sidewalk, we would greatly appreciate it.
Or for that matter, across the streets.
Or
because,
yeah, right.
You know, we have a lot of areas like Fair Acres where that is occurring and, you know, people are using the streets, so.
Walk around your walk around your property,
right,
and think about somebody on a bike, somebody walking, and your line of sight 5 feet on either side,
right,
and above your head.
Well,
sure you aren't hitting things.
And in some instances, it becomes a traffic hazard.
Sure.
I mean, cars can't see to pull in or out. Children are dashing out from behind bushes into the street because you can't see them. So, I mean, it does become a hazard as well. So, not just an inconvenience. So if anyone has any other questions about my report, otherwise I'll just leave you to read it.
The process of hiring a new superintendent?
Actually, the applications closed today at 4:30, and I have three applications. One of them is Brad Ault, who is our interim, and then there are two others. It's likely that I will, upon reviewing them and finding them all to be qualified, I will probably interview them all.
Great. Thank you.
Patty, just one question. Stop signs.
Stop signs.
Who's responsible for vegetation growing?
Our crew.
Okay.
Is there a particular one? Is it Herman Street again? That one's always a problem.
No, I was just wanting folks to make sure that if they have an issue there.
Absolutely. If there is a problem with any traffic control sign on a village street, which does not include State Route 68, but we can pass it on to ODOT, please email either myself or Jason Hamby, who is our street superintendent, and we will take care of it.
Okay, thank you. John?
And just to kind of piggyback on what Patty said about clearance, the village grass ordinance is in effect now starting July 1st, and we are going around and taking pictures of tall grass. So just a general reminder to residents that the first 10 feet from the street or their front property line needs to be mowed, and the 5 feet from the rear and side property lines. We will be sending out notices, and also if things get to the point where they are not cutting grass or weeds, then that will trigger some additional assessment costs and remediation from the village. So that will be in effect now.
I'm sorry, can I go backwards one? I also included in your packets the information from the Center for Urban and Public Affairs on the renewal, the levy survey, just so that you have it for future agenda. Okay, sorry, John, thanks.
Oh, that's fine. And the other thing is I want to introduce our new intern all the way from Centerville and University of Worcester, Scott Sears. Do you want to stand up?
Here.
He's here right here and in the audience.
Being regaled by our...
And actually, I wanted to make Scott official.
There you go. You're getting pinned.
You got to.
Right, yeah. Village pinned.
So Scott is with us until near the end of August, and he'll be helping us with the code enforcement. He'll be helping with zoning enforcement and permitting, and also we'll be conducting the sidewalk inventory that we discussed at the special meetings in June and May. So
comfortable shoes.
Lots of walking.
We're happy to have them. Other than that, I was going to tell you guys the dates for my trip to Malaysia, but you already know that. So if you have any questions for my report, I'm happy to answer them.
Okay. Judy? Well, Babette O'Reilly has moved on to a fuller time position. Wish her well. And we've completed interviews for her replacement and have extended an offer. So pending the result of background checks and other invasive testing, we should be able to make
that.
A friendly and happy announcement about that.
Are you going to detail
me? No,
let's not.
Invasive
testing.
We're not going to go there.
Suffice it to say, we're very careful.
I just heard the Environmental Commission perk up.
Okay, let's see. So we've talked about the agenda, so I don't know that we need to revisit the agenda items. So July 20th, 6 to 7, we will have a special meeting where we will be discussing legislation. There will be the two Antioch College ordinances about giving alley vacations. We will have legislation to make modifications to our AMP electric portfolio. We will have legislation regarding a 1% pay increase for our staff, and then we will move on to the work session at 7 o'clock about policing.
Can I just mention one other thing? I think we need to talk about the Channel 5 station manager. Not tonight, but I don't know if that goes on July 20th
as
well.
That's right, she gave us a report last month.
Yeah, and we're I think now pretty close to past the 4-week extension. So I don't know if that's...
So are we at a point, I guess, what do we need to do? What action do we need to take? Well, we need to have legislation. That's the question. What...
Well, it... Likely, yes, because
it's beyond your amount of money to
most
spend
likely,
without
yes.
counsel.
I haven't done the calculation, but probably, yes.
Okay.
So you do need a resolution at the next meeting?
So, I mean, does that fine with everybody to approach it that way, or do we want to have a discussion first? We can have the discussion because we do have, as part of the work session, that does include commission reports.
Right.
Okay.
So that could potentially be wrapped into the...
I don't see a problem with an extension until after the discussion if you want to do it under commission reports.
Okay.
Because that won't exceed anything.
Susan, okay with that.
Just as long as it's on our radar.
Yeah, thanks for reminding me.
But my understanding is that we have somebody that's interested in continuing, so.
Oh, really?
Which is great news. So.
And Marianne, I guess that is something to work into your schedule, that we will need 15, 20 minutes for, I mean, there will be other business as part of the work session. We will review briefly any communications we've received.
Well, how much time does council want to spend on the police discussion.
Well, I think you were right, hour and a half. We just, you know, we may end up having a little longer meeting.
Okay. So let's see, I guess, oh, and so I need a motion to go into executive session for the purpose of the discussion of the village manager's annual review.
And could we take a slight break before
second?
We do that?
Yes.
But,
okay.
Yes.
All in favor?
Wintrow.
Yes.
Asplund.
Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
Yes.
McQueen.
Yes.
Can we get, well, I
yes, yes.